K98 Talk is expanding its lineup for 2015. This means we are expanding our advertising base. Whether you're a startup trying to push through to the next level, or an established business trying to supplement your advertising budget, web-based advertising is a solid investment. Thanks to Talk's newest partnership with TuneIn Radio and instant access to our sister station, K98 FM, we give you worldwide access at a reasonable cost. Interested parties should email us at sales@k98fm.com. K98talk.com, a leader in internet radio. So grab your seatbelts and take the ride of your life on K98talk.com.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
They say we offer simple answers to complex problems, but perhaps there is a simple answer, not an easy answer. Simple.
It's Common Ground. It's Common Ground. It's Common Ground. It's Common Ground.
We have serious problems to solve, and we need serious people to solve them.
Republicans and Democrats.
All right, folks, it is Saturday morning. It is 9 o'clock Central, a little after 10 o'clock Eastern, and that means it is time for Finding Common Ground. I'm one half of the crew, Rick Robinson, joined today by my co-host, Bryce Robbins, who has been on hiatus for the last couple of weeks. Welcome back, sir. How are you?
Hello. I am good, and it is great to be back. I'm actually... It was kind of upset. It was very upsetting having to go... my Saturdays and not waking up early, putting on the headset. I really missed it. So I'm just so glad to be back.
Awesome. Well, yeah, you've definitely been missed while you were gone. Although I have to admit, last Saturday was kind of nice because I figured out a way to basically just queue up replay after replay after replay. So I didn't, it was basically everything was running on autopilot. So I was like hanging out, goofing off in Twitter while I was technically on the air at the same time. It was kind of fun. So, what exactly were you up to while you were away? I've noticed a new page that you sent me an invite to.
So, I am in this organization. It's a really popular organization in high schools all over the country, even all over the world. It's called JSA, Junior States of America. And what it is it's essentially a debating and social type of thing. But I'm running for vice mayor of the New Jersey region. So every Saturday, it's kind of like we're in a campaign season right now, meeting people, getting voters, talking to people. So the past Saturdays is when they've been held the little chapter conferences, building up to what's going to be next Saturday. Is I'll be gone for the last time, and that's when the election is. And hopefully I get my votes, and hopefully I win.
Well, that could be awesome.
That would be awesome.
I could,
and of course, I would boast all about, K98. In fact, that is one of the key points that I've been pointing out, and everybody thinks it's amazing that I have this thing under my belt that we're doing radio. So definitely, probably get a lot of listeners from that.
Oh, well, that would be completely cool. But yeah, so I never asked before because I kept hearing you during your last show that you did live on OpNet. You were talking to the guy who at some point I might actually try to talk into being the younger version of me at some point if I decide to move away from this show. And you were talking about the fact that you were running for something and you kept mentioning Bryce for Vice, but I had no idea what you were talking about. I was like, dude, are you trying to get to be like a cop or something?
Well, Liam is my campaign manager. We go back a little bit, and he's a great guy. The whole Bryce for Vice is for vice mayor. I'm also running a sting operation in Chinatown where I walk in, I buy a pair of sunglasses, and then the squad comes in, takes out all the guys. So, a little vice everywhere.
Nice. That was pretty quick thinking. That's good.
Right.
All right. So, been keeping up with any of the new stuff while you've been launching your political career?
Of course I
am. Mr. Vice Mayor?
Of course I am. I'm appalled with India. Indiana.
We're all appalled with India, but that's another show.
You know, I have to say, I actually just posted it on Opinion Nation News' Facebook page. It was a post. When NASCAR and Walmart are against you, you must be a bigot.
I know, I've seen it.
I was laughing for a good 5 minutes at that one. Because
I have a question.
Yeah, go for it.
Does that make Obama a bigot?
Wow, touche. Okay, round one goes to Rick. That was not only quick thinking, but you got me there. Okay.
Well, no, I'm just curious because here's the thing that I don't understand. I know the dynamic has changed and everything has shifted and everything's all about, you know, the fact that us Christian conservatives are trying to discriminate against, let me just do this right so it sounds okay. Us Christian conservatives are trying to discriminate against that there, them, their homosexual types. That's not what this is about. Obama supported the same law when he was in the Senate in Illinois. It's the same damn law. Word for word, almost. It's the same damn law. Clinton passed the same thing at the national level in the 90s. Nobody said a word. I don't understand the uproar, except for the fact that right now it's a hot button issue, and everybody's like, oh, they're going to use that to discriminate against gays. No, we're going to try to use that so when we say, hey, you know, I'm a little busy, but there's a cake shop down the street that'd be more than happy to work for you. Oh, no, you're just turning me down because I'm gay. I'm going to go talk to my attorney. No, I'm turning you down because, as you can see, I've opened my books to you, and I have no slots for the next 3 months because we're really popular. And yeah, so here, Johnny Smith down the street runs another cake shop. Go talk to him. He may have the business. No, screw you. I'm going to sue you. Or no, what about when we, now that gay marriage is becoming legal, and probably will when Supreme Court gets around to it, which, in my opinion, I'm a little mixed on that one, just to be honest. I think they deserve the same rights as everybody else. I don't like the fact that we are rearranging and redefining the word marriage, but that's another story. But what happens when a Baptist church refuses to marry a gay couple? Do they have religious freedom to do so, or are they going to be sued as well? Because at that point, you truly are making a religious organization that plainly says who they are try to do something that they completely despise. And let's be honest, the real reason that these type of laws are being passed everywhere is because of the Hobby Lobby situation. It doesn't have anything to do with gay marriage. But that's what everybody wants to make it about. Because it's a great distraction, because we're missing the fact that Obama's going to make sure we all glow in the dark here in about the next decade or so if we're not careful.
Well, I mean, we all know that I don't always agree with Obama, even though I do put him on a pedestal.
But, whatever, suck up.
But in regard to this law, and I know you bring up the argument, you know, you can always just go buy your cake or whatever somewhere else. But the fact of the matter is, the money in a gay person's wallet is the same color, same tender as the money in a straight person's wallet. So if I want my business at a certain store, there's no reason why they should be discriminating against me because of my personal preference in sexuality, in whatever type of things that I like. I mean,
no shirt, no shoes, no service.
No personal preferences should be added to that. I mean, we are a nation of equality, though. I feel that we were
built. But that's my point. Do you really think that the reason that that whole thing started was because of health code violations? No. But it still happens today. No shirt, no shoes, no service. Not only that, but if you really want to stop and think about it for a second, this is a completely out of bounds argument. Because again, these laws were started for the very reasons that the Obama administration has already tried to overreach when they tried to make Hobby Lobby sell things that they were opposed to, because they sell themselves as exactly what they are, a Christian organization. And you can make arguments about that all you want, but the simple fact of the matter is, they even when you walk into the stores, it, right there on the door, it says our businesses will always be closed on Sunday so that our staff has time for family, friends, and worship. I mean, it's not like they're hiding who they are. And here's the other point that really pisses me off. Nobody's talking about all the Muslim bakers that are refusing to bake gay wedding cakes. No one. But they're there. I found video after video after video this week of people that are videotaping Muslim shop owners that are turning away gay people. Nobody's saying a fucking word. But a Christian does it. Oh my God, it's the end of the world.
Well, let me ask you this in reverse, because I do agree with you on that point. But what if Christians weren't discriminating in this sense and it was just Muslims? I think a lot of people would be outraged that Muslims were discriminating against...
Oh, no, they wouldn't. No, they wouldn't. They would be quiet... Hang on, let me clarify. They would be quietly, silently outraged. Because this administration has taught everyone over the last 7 years that you can't get upset with Muslims, and you can't, if you disagree with what they're saying, tell them that what they're doing is wrong, because even the administration is afraid that if you piss one off, they're going to put on a bomb vest. So no, there would be no public outcry, because everyone's afraid to do it.
I don't know. I mean, I think we're seeing a lot more outcry against, you know, Islamic fundamentalists and Muslims in general in this country. And I think a lot of, in a lot of ways, it's going in a wrong direction. I don't know if you saw it, but it went pretty viral really quick. It was in Texas. They have the it's the Muslim Citizens Day, I believe it is, something of that nature. And they were giving these Muslim students were giving a speech about how they are proud to be American and they're happy to live in America. And this lady who went viral on this monster drink commercial came on the microphone, overtook the teenager speaking, and was saying how Muhammad would never rise in America, that, you know, Jesus will protect America, things like that. And I think we do need to stomp out the idea of Islamic fundamentalists, you know, coming to America, but we need tolerance. And we need tolerance for the LGBT community. We need tolerance for Muslims, Christians, Jews, whatever it may be. And on the topic of Jews, happy Passover. But, you know, I really think that once you start saying, you know, you have the right to deny access to a business because it's the owner's religious freedom, I think that really enters a slippery slope. Because what if one day it becomes someone's, you know, religious freedom to think that they are above somebody else? So for that reason, we can, you know, deny access to African Americans. Because in the Bible, there are hierarchies in society.
Oh, come on. Let's not even go down that road, because the segregation, this is the part nobody wants to talk about. There was not a personal choice to segregate. Those were folks that were following government mandated laws. They were required to segregate. So let's face it. In this day and age, nobody's going to look at a black person and say, I'm sorry, you can't be in my shop. Unless they're drunk, stoned, or high and doing stuff, something stupid. But that's my whole point. So now, using this same argument, if I wanted to, I could go into a Muslim deli who serves nothing but halal, and technically I should be able to sue them because they won't serve me bacon.
No, not at all. That's not what I'm
Why saying. Not? It's the same damn thing. My religious preference allows me to eat bacon, so why the hell should they not be able to serve me bacon just because their religious preference says they can't touch pork? It's the same damn thing.
No. Here's where that's different, is that when we have somebody who is, let's say I'm a store owner and I say, nope, I can't serve you because your preferences in the bedroom don't align with my religion. Automatically, that is wrong.
But here's the thing. We're only talking about one specific set of services. Nobody's saying they shouldn't be able to go into restaurants. Nobody's saying that they shouldn't be able to do this. Nobody's saying that they shouldn't be able to go in and order any liquor that they want. What we're talking about is the fact that we're going to have shop owners who, because of their personal religious beliefs, do not want to partake or have their cakes or services associated with gay weddings. As far as I'm concerned, that is freedom of religious expression. It also means that let the market decide. It's really simple. If Joe doesn't want to bake you a cake because you're gay, go talk to John down the street. He'll probably bake you a cake. And then John gets more business because Joe doesn't want to serve gay people. Eventually, Joe probably goes out of business. But why does Joe deserve to be sued? Because he doesn't want to serve a cake at a gay wedding.
Okay, well, here's the problem. And in response to that, well, I have to make the point that, you know, Governor Pence even said, if I walked into a restaurant and I saw gay people being denied access, then I wouldn't eat there anymore. And it just brings the question to my mind, then why are you signing this bill in the first place? Because it is clear that they're providing a license to discriminate.
It's the same damn law signed in Illinois. So when people get up in arms about that law, then they can bitch at Indiana. Because the same law has been in Illinois for how many years? It was when Obama was a senator, for God's sake. So let's put – you can't keep spinning that this direction, because the discrimination's not happening in Illinois. It's not there. So you can't keep spinning that in that direction. The law's the law is on the books in 20 states.
I'm not agreeing with one, and I'm not agreeing with any of them. I think that it's just wrong in general to discriminate.
But the simple fact of the matter is, the law in practice is not doing what your side is claiming that it's going to do. It's been in existence for years. No one's being discriminated against anywhere.
How is it against one's religion? In the Bible, one of the only verses where it's saying against homosexuality is that thou shalt not lay with another man. It doesn't say that thou shalt not bake a cake for two men who want to get married, who then might commit a sin. And in addition to that, if we want to look at the Bible, all sins are equal. So, you know, a lie
is I'm the first one to make that argument. But again, if someone, because of their personal religious convictions, doesn't want to bake someone a cake because they don't agree with the fact that they think they should be able to get married because of the fact that they don't agree with homosexuality, they deserve to be out of business. They don't deserve to be sued. It's that simple. Because, I mean, come on. We keep making laws to reestablish the First Amendment of the fucking Constitution. That law is the law of the land. I know Obama doesn't want it to be, because let's face it, he hasn't been very protective of it. He's spying on his own citizens. He's got the IRS working as a Gestapo arm for the people that he doesn't agree with. I mean...
You want to talk about spying on citizens? Let's not forget it was Bush who enacted the Patriot Act in the first place. That started.
And yes, sir, it was. And that's why even at that time I was screaming against it and saying, look, this is not a good idea. First of all, anything that has the word patriot in the title means somebody's trying to give you a snow job. Second of all, same thing I've said, continue to say, and will always say, is even if you're comfortable with your side having the power that they are now about to be able to wield, are you going to be just as comfortable with it when it's the other side's turn? If the answer to that question is no, that law shouldn't be passed. And I, as well as many other conservatives, started railing against the idea as soon as it was passed, because now that's exactly what's happened, is the other side has gotten a hold of it, and now they've turned the Patriot Act into this steroid mongoloid monster, which basically spies on everybody, uses the Gestapo, or the IRS as stormtroopers, and it's just crazy. The whole damn thing needs to be repealed, and I said that the day it was passed.
Well, I mean, let's not get it wrong, though. I do think that we do need security. But I do agree with you that, you know, I don't want to live in a 1984 police state. But I also don't think that they're spying on people like you and me. And even if they are, I don't think they're – you know what? Actually, it is just wrong. I mean, I'm not going to sugarcoat it. It's wrong.
Let's face it. They are, because I've seen too many reports of things that scared the crap out of me that at first I thought there's no freaking way, and then I took one apart. A lot of those digital coding boxes, you know, the ones they made everybody go to because they claimed they were going to free up the UHF and VHF frequencies for emergency uses only, so they had everybody convert to digital bandwidth because they could shrink it.
Mm-hmm.
Most of those boxes have cameras in them. I know this because I've taken one apart. It has a little device that looks remarkably like a webcam sitting right at the front of the box. Why is there a camera in a TV box?
Oh my goodness, that would be scary. I mean,
now I can't say that all of them do, because I have taken apart more than one, because, you know, I'm just one of those guys where somebody will be like, hey, this is broke, see if you can fix it. And I'm a tinker. So one of my relatives, one of their decoder boxes went out. So like, hey, I'm not sure, but I know you're pretty good with electronics. Why don't you take this apart, see if you can get it put back together? I took it apart and I about pissed myself, because there's right up the front a little device that looks remarkably like a webcam. And I'm like, I kind of wondered what that pinhole was for. I thought that was the power light. Oh, shit.
Well, I mean, if that was the case, and I don't know if it is, and I don't think any of us really do, I think it's a lot of, speculation, but I think that, I don't know what the government's incentive would be to just spy on the people all the time. Unless, I mean, other than the fact that it would be incredibly fun and amusing, like Obama just sitting at his laptop pretending to do work, just like, oh, hello, Mr. Jones, what are you doing today? Like, I would probably do that for hours, but I don't see the incentive other than stopping terrorism.
Yeah, I mean, like I said, I don't know. But at this point, we've kind of completely gotten off topic. So give me a second, because I want to cue something up real quick, provided I can find it, because we've been adding a lot of new stuff in here lately. So give me just a sec.
Not a problem. You know, let me ask you, I'm sure you covered this in one of your shows. What did you think about what happened in your state with the college, with the fraternity?
Actually, I thought we had talked about that before, but yeah, we can talk about that again. I mean, it's terrible. It shouldn't have happened. I honestly kind of think that the banning of the fraternity, I can see. The expulsion of the students, I'm afraid they may have actually overreached on that one, and I think it may come back to bite them in the butt. Not that I don't agree with the fact that they should have tried it. I'm kind of thinking that at some point somebody's First Amendment rights is going to come back and smack OU right square in the face. And sadly, I think that's probably exactly what's going to happen. I do, because I know folks that work for OU, so I am glad to see that President Bourne stepped up and took quick action. So I don't disagree with anything that he did. The one thing that I keep reiterating, even to my children, now that most of them are older, we don't live in a day and age where you can be just a stupid kid anymore, because everybody's got a camera, everybody's got access to YouTube, so you can't just run around and randomly spout off crap and think it's funny and not expect to face the consequences later, because somebody's probably got a damn camera on you whether you want them to or not. And that's one of the things that honestly makes me a little sad about today, because if I grew up in a world where everything went onto social media as soon as it happened, there were so many things that I probably would have gotten in trouble for. I'm just saying.
Well, I mean, I agree with you, but I think that, well, there's kind of two arguments here, is that, you know, it was a traditional song that they did pass down, and although it was wrong, he definitely, that boy Lewis, I think his name was, wasn't the first person to sing that song, and I feel that, you know, it's kind of it's a little unfair that one person is taking the rap because he was the one who was videotaped by some idiot. But then again, there are certain things that you should know. You know, you don't do this. And I think that was one of those things where you should have known going into it, you don't do this, and that's where it went wrong.
Yeah, I mean, my biggest thing with it, and I really thought we had talked about this, but hang on a second. Since you brought this up, I was looking for another clip, but I think I have one that will fit what we're talking about right now, so bear with me for a moment.
No problem.
I don't think I actually put them in the library, though. No, I was just playing them straight from the feeds. Never mind, I don't have that one. Okay, anyway, I can't really play it, but there is a clip that came out a few days after that incident that really disturbed me. And it actually ran right in Oklahoma. I don't know if it happened in Oklahoma or not, but it ran on a news channel's website for a little bit until they figured out it wasn't, that the video wasn't made by OU students, and then they seemed to feel the need to pull it back down. But there was a video that was done shortly after this one that basically had a group of African American males sitting around what appears to be some sort of a small apartment in a living room, and they were sitting around on a couch chanting about how if they ever saw anybody from SAE, they were going to beat the crap out of them, and how they're not welcome in the hood, and yada, yada, yada. And then every time, for punctuation, as one of the verses ended, the one sitting on the end of the couch would point a gun and start making the words, or start saying the words, bet, 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 but making it sound like a gunshot was going off. So they were chanting about beating the crap out of fraternity members, and one of them was glorifying the fact that if he had the chance, he would shoot them. But nobody really got outraged over that one.
Well, let me just give a little response to that before we move on here, is that I'm not condoning what they did, and I think it is wrong, and I do think it is not acceptable that that was a response. Although it wasn't the official, you know, response, I think that when people carry themselves like that, it's not right. But we must remember that this country, and it hasn't been long ago since, we've had a very divisive history in this country between blacks and whites. And although that doesn't give them the right to do it, you can see if you're growing up in a low-income area where it's largely been, you know, you've been assimilated to the same people, we can see why people grow up like that and see why people feel so oppressed in this nation still to this day. But again, I'm clarifying, I'm not condoning that, but, I mean, I understand it more coming from that, but
qualify your statements by default, you are condoning them, sir.
I don't give them the, you know, the green light saying, you know, that's a good thing to do, but I can understand
why. As soon as you said but, you lost your argument.
it seems more typical coming from...
Careful, you're about to sound like a racist.
Yeah, I'm sounding like a racist. Okay, you know what? Let's move on here. I'll just finish it here. Is that it just seems more understandable coming from that sect of society, because it just seems that they feel so oppressed, especially if you look at the news, if you look at everything, what's happening with young African Americans, especially in the media, is being played up.
Well, of course they feel oppressed. They have people of color in the Senate talking about, or Congress talking about, being freed slaves.
Yeah. So, you know.
I mean, you know, never mind the fact that slavery ended 200 years ago. But yeah, we have a, never mind. All right. So, we got a late start, so I let things run a little bit long, but we really do need to take a quick break, folks. We'll be right back here in just a second.
We're gonna spread happiness. We're gonna spread freedom. Obama's gonna change it. Obama's gonna lead 'em.
So let me be clear. You didn't build that.
Everything he's done is clean as a whistle. He's never not only broken any law, he's never done anything wrong. He's the perfect father, the perfect husband, the perfect American.
Hey, y'all. This is Sam Janney, or the Bunny, as many of you know me by, your friendly neighborhood bad girl of conservatism. Here to talk to you about my show. I'll talk about conservative issues, my top 10 douchebags of the week, and have some pretty badass conservative guests on the show. All that, plus me, your resident bunny with a chainsaw.
Wednesday nights will never be the same. It's Unapologetically Bunny, Wednesdays, 9 p.m. Eastern, right here on K98 Talk.
Hey everybody, this is Jason, host of According to Me. I'd like to invite you to check out my show. It's a two-hour show that lasts 60 minutes in...
Listen, I hate to interrupt, but one thing I can do is read off a script. Just say, let me be clear a lot. It works.
President Obama, I can handle this. It's a radio promo. I'm not green. I've done this before.
Did someone say green?
Now, Al Gore is here. Listen, I'm just trying to record a radio promo. Do you mind?
Now, do you say good things about me on the show?
No, not at all. But if it makes you feel any better, I rip on Republicans just as much.
The AM radio frequencies give off very high levels of radiation.
Look, my show is on the internet, which you invented. Can I just do my promo?
I got a pen. I can veto that, you know.
I know you got a pen. It's not a law. It's a radio promo. Listen, just listen to my show. Barack Obama and Al Gore hate it, so you're going
to
love it.
Here's an executive order. Don't listen to his show. He doesn't like me. He's racist.
And he doesn't recycle either.
That's it. I'm done. It's According to Me, Wednesdays, 10 p.m. Eastern, right here on K98 Talk.
This is Misty, owner of Wax It Studio in Edmond, Oklahoma, and I'm here to talk to you about a skincare product called Theramedics. Theramedics has a wonderful line of products from anti-aging to hyperpigmentations all the way to acne. In fact, everyone at some point in our lives is affected by acne. Acne can cause a great deal of embarrassment and anxiety. And in order to prevent and help other people, I have tapped into this wonderful product called Theramedics. Visit my website at www.prettyskindeep.com. Again, that's www.prettyskindeep.com.
A show that will change internet radio as you know it.
Okay, so let's talk about the story, which I think is hilarious. I'm just going to refer to it as the poop plane, because, like, what else are you going to call it? But there was this plane, okay? It took off. It's the British Airways. They were going to Dubai. I have a hard time pronouncing that one.
Are you? It was British anyway, Airways? It wasn't Jet.
British
it wasn't,
Airways.
Wasn't Jet Poo?
It was.
Couldn't resist. I'm sorry.
I like it. This story BM is we've ever had a story that is up our alley. It's this one. It's bathroom humor up from front to back of the airplane, apparently. They had to turn around to go back to Heathrow because they said the smelly poo in the toilet became unbearable for passengers, and it was so bad. They decided it's so bad that they had to turn around and go back rather than continue their flight. They decided that there wasn't enough Febreze, there wasn't enough anything to handle this.
Maybe they should see a doctor. Is there a GoFundMe for this guy?
It must be a woman, because a woman's going to be mortified and embarrassed. If this is a guy, you know that he's, like, out there on Twitter and everything else saying, dude, I took down an airplane with how bad that I laid it down.
There was an old woman who flew on jet poo. She ate so many burritos, she didn't know what to do.
So we turned the plane around because they made a big stink. We've just made it into a haiku at the end, but there had to be some
real serious nonsense. Mondays, 9 p.m. Eastern Time, now on K98 Talk.
Folks, we're back. We're live. This is Finding Common Ground. I'm Rick Robinson, joined by Bryce Robbins today. So far, we have kind of been all over the map. So if you missed the first half hour, you should go back and listen to it later. Biggest thing we've really been talking about has been the Indiana thing. Can't really find consensus there because, you know, it's fine for Illinois to do it, but God forbid Indiana does it. Never mind the fact that Bill Clinton did the same thing. And I know you didn't really say that. Calm down. Don't have an aneurysm over there. Okay, so another thing that I think is kind of important that we talk about, and this one I actually do have sound clips for, and one other thing before I forget, because I usually try to do this as we come back from break, two big announcements. One, there's a new group joining Politainment that will also be featured here on K98 Talk. Don't know that much about them yet, but with the Rockstar group they have over there, I'm sure they wouldn't have been wanting to bring them over if they weren't worthy, so they're going to be assuming the the promo that you just heard for Real Serious Nonsense, this Monday they will not appear. That group is going to be on in their place, and then they will assume their regular normal time slots here now, Tuesday nights at 9 Eastern the following week. So make sure you tune in and check them out, folks, because like I said, if they've been invited to join Bunny and their crew, they've got to already be rock stars in their own right. So you should give them a listen. Also, Steve Long, who has always been a part of the Spark Radio Network, is now returning to K98Talk.com for live broadcasts. His new time slots will now be Monday evenings at 7 p.m. So he'll be right in the middle of the transition between the Spark Radio Network and the Politetainment crew, because on 6 o'clock you'll have me, myself, then him at 7, then what will usually be Real Serious Nonsense. Speaking of which, I think we have Steve calling in right now. Steve, are you there, sir?
He appears.
Hey, that's one of those usual things. Speak of the devil, and all of a sudden the phone starts ringing. How are you this morning, sir?
I'm good. Just got back.
I never left.
Well, I just got back to the house.
So. Yeah, I know. I'm just giving you a hard time. You said you just got back. I said I never left. I thought it would be funny. It didn't work. Never mind.
This time.
All right. So, since you are here, I'll let you finish the announcement, because I was just making the announcement of your triumphant return, and you're here.
I heard my name. That's my ear was twitching or something, I guess. but I didn't hear everything that you said, so where did you leave off?
Well, basically, I had just started talking about the fact that you were going to be joining us on Monday nights at 7 as the cleanup hitter for the Spark crew, and then we'll switch over to the Politetainment crew as usual from 8 to 10, and then I was just about to pull up your email so I could let them know who your guest and stuff was going to be. So since you're here, why don't you take that away?
So my guest on Monday night is there's nobody in the chat room. My guest on Monday night.
I'm terrible with the chat. I never use it. Just saying.
Where was I? His name is Jeffrey Tucker, and he is an author, a very prolific author. Wrote a book called A Beautiful Anarchy. Trying to think of the name of the rest of his books, sir. He is the CEO of a social media network called Liberty Me, or Liberty.me, sorry. He's been on the show before, and trying to pull up a list of his books here. There's another one called Bit by Bit. That had the word Jetsons in the title, and I was just reading that the other day, and I can't remember the name of it. It's A Jetsons World.
It's A Jetsons World? Is that what you said?
Yeah, It's A Jetsons World. That was a book he wrote in, I'll say it was like last year, maybe.
Funny thing I had just made a similar comment on Twitter the other night, because I'm reading through articles getting ready for the show, and I've got the TV going, and I had just finished reading an article about a flying car that might actually make it into production, and then as soon as I turn around, because this commercial caught my attention, there's a commercial about virtual doctor's visits. I'm like, holy crap, the Jetsons is finally here.
Yeah, I mean, the book was essentially about how it's more, you know, it's more based on technology, and how a lot of the technology in the Jetsons cartoon has.
Sorry, Bryce, I didn't realize we lost you. Are you back?
Oh, yeah, hello.
More or less has, in some way, shape, or form, has come to fruition. And one of the key points he makes in there is throughout the show of the Jetsons, there's a somewhat lack of hierarchical structures, that is, of the government. There's really no government to be found in the Jetsons, but yet all of this technology flourishes. So definitely have to check it out. sometime. Anyway, point being, he's an author. He's the CEO of Liberty.me. He's been on the show before, and so we're going to be talking about practical anarchy. Should be an interesting show. Sandwich between Angie and Clay.
Yeah, you'll be on. I'll open for you. You'll open for them, and it should make Monday nights really, really cool.
Yeah, I was talking to Angie yesterday about that after we had made the decision, and she responded with one of the comments she made was, "We're destined to be on the same station, no matter what." we were both on war at the same time.
Yeah, I know. You guys were all on there around the same time. That's actually – I honestly – I hope Sam's not listening, but I had no idea she had a podcast and a show till you moved over to war, because I started keeping up with yours, and then I found all of theirs, and I'm like, dude, some of these shows are really cool, and then I got into listening to them, and then they were gone, and I'm like, where'd they go? And then when they disappeared, I was like – and by then, Sam and I had become really good friends on Twitter, so I was kind of bending her ear about, hey, got a station over here, lots of room, come on. And then she makes the announcement about 405, and I was like, ah, crap. I was like, I still want to carry your show. So then we worked out that deal, and of course, the guys at 405 were not very receptive to me live streaming their shows at the same time, which was my plan, because we do that for all kinds of other places, or we did until we started getting so much live content of our own. And then it was like, well, I'll still run the podcast, and it was great, because, you know, it gave them another outlet, and then, you know, things went the way they did, which I will not talk about on air, because that's out of respect to Sam. If she wants people to know what happened, she's more than welcome to tell them. I'm not going to. And now they're all here, and now you're back, and I'm all warm and fuzzy. Probably won't last long, but I am warm and fuzzy for the moment.
I mean, I'm not leaving the current network for any ill feelings toward them. There was nothing really went wrong. I just kind of wanted to come back home.
Yeah, I don't. Okay, so this is just a public service announcement for those of you that like to use the chat, because Bunny Screw uses it a lot. I'm sure Steve will use it because he's used to it. I'm a good multitasker, but I usually have Twitter open and a million other things going on, so chat's usually one of the last things I worry about. That, and until I get a slightly better system built up, I can't have too many things open on a single computer, and if I open up too much on my laptop when I'm trying to screen callers, it goes crazy too. So, which today I didn't even bother to bring out the laptop, which is why Steve just kind of got brought directly in, and poor Bryce was put on hold and had no idea what was going on because I'd hit the wrong button.
Well, I came into the house and turned on my computer and turned on the show, and the first thing I heard was my name, so I was like, oh, I'm going to call him now.
All right, but yeah, so apparently folks are having a hard time finding the chat on K98 Talk, which really doesn't make much sense to me, since there's a big black banner across the top of the screen.
There's a big...
And one of them says chat. I don't know why they're having a hard time finding it.
It's not that complicated. Maybe. Let me see something here.
So this was going to be my suggestion. For those of you that like to use it, when you're in the chat, there are buttons. There are social media sharing buttons at the top. I would just click on all of those links and send them all out from your own Twitter accounts. That way people know when you're in the chat, because that gives them a link that will send them straight there. Because
you can do. I don't know if this will work, but there's a direct link to the chat room. So like when you're promoting your show, maybe you can just give them that link.
Well, yeah, but that's what I'm saying. It will do that automatically if you just click on the social media boxes at the top of the chat. That's what it does, is it pushes out those links.
Okay.
And that way nobody has to bookmark the link. But I'm just saying, because we do have lots of folks that are excited about the fact that we have a chat, and I have lots of folks that gripe at me because I'm almost never in it. Sadly, like I said, since I produce myself, it's a real pain in the ass to try to have Twitter up, because I still get more feedback from Twitter than I do from the chat anyway. I get more feedback from Twitter than I do anywhere. I get maybe 1 to 2 emails a week, and I get like message after message after message from Twitter. So Twitter's going to kind of be where I'm going to stay for a while, because I can have that open and it just kind of sit there, and then I can kind of go back and respond later, even if I can't get to it right away. The chat's not the same way, because once it gets busy, it's so fluid that people will be trying to get to talk to you, and then they're mad because you're not responding, and it's because by the time you go back in and look, you can't see what they said. The chat, the first night that the Politetainment group used it was Monday, and for us, their chat was full. For them, they were like, yeah, it was kind of lame. I'm like, dude, you have like 40 people in the chat room. We usually have maybe two. Maybe. And that's usually a host and somebody else. I'm just saying.
I'll have to get people to come into the chat, because I do the chat every week.
Well, yeah, that's one of the reasons why I put it in there, is because I know there are lots of hosts that like to have the chat, and I would like to be one of them, but I can't. And if I ever get a computer put together, it will actually do everything that I need it to do without having to use more than one machine. I could probably figure it out. But anyway, so we have monopolized almost the entirety of the last part of the show.
Bryce has been strangely quiet.
Oh, I'm sorry, guys.
Hey. He's been enjoying the fact that other people are talking right now. You know how that gets. You'll be part of a co-host show, and one of them will like completely just start talking, and you're just like, "Heh, I'm just gonna listen for a while." I did that Thursday night when we had Grouchy and I had Mr. Eccles on. Grouchy was asking him some really good questions, and I would keep trying to get in there every so often, and it just, and then as soon as Grouchy would ask a question, Rod would fire off an answer, and I was like, you know what? This is going well enough. I'm just going to mute myself and listen, because every time I try to get in, I feel like I'm breaking up the conversation. So for like 20 minutes, I was like prepping for everything else. I'm like, hey, I'm a producer again. Yay.
Oh, Dave's going to record that bumper for me.
Sweet.
So I'm going to tweak the verbiage on it just a little bit.
So is he doing it in his like wrestling podcast radio voice, or are you doing it as Ronald?
No, he's going to do it in his radio voice. I don't want the Ronald one on this one.
I think he should do it both ways.
Maybe I'll ask him to do that.
Because then at least we have the other one when we really want to irritate people. Just saying. All right, so speaking of the Ronald voice, because it kind of fits what we were talking about before we went to break and then you joined the show, I know you hadn't heard anything till after the break. We had been discussing the Indiana law. You have any thoughts on that?
Groan.
I know. It's boring and mundane and droll for you, but I figured while you were on, I could at least torment you for the last 5 minutes.
Well, my general feeling is that if somebody owns a business and does not want to serve a certain type of clientele, they have that right to. However, they also have the right
to
face whatever consequences there are of that particular discrimination, if you want to call it discrimination. So, you know, if you're a Christian cake maker and you don't want to make a cake for a gay wedding because you think that's against your religious belief, you have that right to. But if a large segment of the population decides to boycott your little cake bakery, that's on you.
Yeah, you said cake bakery like it was a dirty word.
I'm
That being said, I don't think we need and this should come as no surprise to you, I don't think we need the government to come in and say whether or not they can or can't.
Well, I guess my thing with it is, why do we need a tertiary law to enforce to reinforce the First Amendment?
Exactly. Yeah. Why do we need more laws?
And you know, not to keep rubbing this in Bryce's face, but hey, it's been a couple of weeks I've been able to pick on you. His beloved Obama passed the same damn law when he was part of the Illinois Senate. Just saying.
Not only that, but President Clinton passed the same thing when he was president.
Yeah, but it's different when it's liberals.
No, no, it's not. It is just as bad, and that's why it was overturned by the Supreme Court. DOMA, I'm assuming that we're all in reference to here. Or the National Religious Freedom Act that he passed into law. I mean, let's not forget here that it is just blatant discrimination because of one's sexual preference, and just because there's a couple lines in the Bible that say so, that should not give somebody the right to discriminate against somebody else.
Money. Then by God, when I go into a Muslim deli, I want bacon.
Okay, that's fair. Eat your damn bacon and read your Quran. Have fun with it. I mean, we shouldn't be living in a society where I can say to somebody, sorry, you know, I don't want you as a customer because of the way you are. So for that reason, I'm not going to serve you. Even though the money in your wallet is just as good as somebody else's, no.
And I don't think that's really First but Amendment, here's the thing, Bryce, and this is what nobody wants to talk about, nobody wants to think about. If the government would get out of the way, the market would decide. That's all of fair. These people that are turning away the business would be pushing it to other places. Those places would be the one that would make more money, to make more cakes, to expand their businesses. And eventually the people that are selectively serving whoever they're serving, they're going to go away because they're not going to make the money. The reason segregation worked is because it was government mandated. If we get the government out of the way and let dumbasses be dumbasses, then eventually those dumbasses will go away because they won't have any business.
But yeah, it's like selective commerce is going to go away whether the government mandates it or not.
Yeah, but if we're acknowledging that they're dumbasses and that they are...
But that's the point, Bryce. They are dumbasses, and eventually they are going to go away unless the government makes them stay open and do things that they don't want, which is ultimately going to cost society more money in the long run, which doesn't make any sense. Let the market decide. If you don't want to bake somebody a cake because you don't want to serve a cake at a gay wedding, that is up to you. That should be your choice. Let the 5 other bakers in your town take that business away from you, and eventually probably nobody will come to your shop because they'll figure out that you're not wanting to serve gay people.
All right. I mean, I'm going to hold my belief here and say that regardless of who you are, where you come from, it just seems to be a very slippery slope. In the sense that if I don't agree with you, then now
but,
I don't have
but to again, you're using a historical frame of reference which isn't valid because you're looking back at segregation. That only worked because it was government mandated. That's the only reason that stuff hung around for as long as it did was because it was government mandated. Even if somebody opens a shop and says, hey, I don't want – I mean, let's just be completely honest. Even if somebody opens a shop and says, hey, I don't want to serve African Americans, eventually that shop's going to go away because, first of all, they're probably going to get torched by an African American. Second of all, nobody's going to go in there. The only reason segregation worked was because it was government mandated. If the government would get out of the way, the market would fix itself.
Wait a second. Why does it have to be an African-American that torches the place? Why can't a white person torch it?
Yeah, white people do a lot of torching.
Well, I was afraid that if I used the phrase white person and torch in the same sentence, it would make it even worse. So. Because that was one of those non-filter moments, and I realized what I said 2 seconds after I said it, and I really was about to say, and then some white person is going to torch it, and I'm like, oh, no, that, no. All right, so we did get a late start, so we have been running a little bit long. I'm not actually sure whether we're up to a full hour yet or not because I don't have the screen in front of me. Looks like we still got about 7 minutes left if you guys want to keep going, or we can change gears to yours since it's a couple minutes after 10, Bryce. It's up to you.
No, please, let's stay here. I really don't mind whatever you guys want to do.
All right, so the last thing I really kind of wanted to touch on, and since we're all here, I'm not going to play the segments because I don't have time for them now because they are kind of long, is the Iran deal. What are you guys' takes on that? And then I'll weigh in last.
Steve, you want to go first?
I wasn't paying attention. I was saying there's still nobody in the chat room. Anyway. Iran deal. I don't know. I've been reading too much about it.
Can I just say the one thing that I find completely humorous is the president that stood in front of the world stage and said, if Iran cheats, we will know. This same guy stands in front of a teleprompter every week and says, I didn't know about that until it happened on the news.
Yeah, he won't know anything. I don't know. I mean, I got it's better than, you know, bombing them, I guess. I don't know.
Well, bombing them wouldn't do anything. It was one guy, I want to say from NATO, a spokeswoman, or maybe it was a spokeswoman from NATO, I forget, said you can't bomb knowledge, that they know how to do it. They're going to get it done. They'll rebuild it. It's as simple as that.
You know, I got to imagine that whether we put all these sanctions on Iran or not, they're going to figure out how to get a bomb because
I thought I was muted.
I don't think anything that we do is going to keep them from building a bomb if they want one. But I don't think
this is what happens when you put Steve on the spot too early in the morning.
No, I mean, he's right. It's a tough decision.
I'm not the biggest fan of American imperialism, so.
I know. That was one of the reasons why I asked, because I figured at this point this would be one of the times we could probably get three different viewpoints.
I don't think we need to get involved in their business at all. I mean, if we want to have friendly trade relations with them, fine. Outside of that, get out of their business.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, you and I are never going to agree on that one, but I mean,
well, I think it is our business when they have a nuclear weapon that could destroy our allies in the region. So,
well, the problem with that is we have the fact that we made allies in the first place.
These are the times that I miss Dave, because he would still be stumbling over whether it's nuclear or nuclear.
I mean, all right. So we made this nuclear deal with Iran. One benefit that's going to come from it, and it's going to hurt oil companies in America, which I'm kind of happy about because, you know, I'm an eco nut, but is that it's going to
– Wait, hang on a second. Let's back that up. An eco nut that is pro-nuclear power. You, sir, are a dichotomy.
No, I am a true eco-friendly person. Nuclear power is the clear way to go if you love the environment.
Until one of them explodes.
No, because how many – there have been over 8,000 oil pipelines have exploded or cracked.
Dude,
or leaked.
I am
or whatever.
I'm just giving you our time right now. Calm down. It's okay.
I know. I'm sorry. I love nuclear power. I explode when people talk bad about it because
– Bad choice of words.
It's ridiculous.
I explode when people talk bad about it.
Yeah, I'm glad you caught onto my pun there.
All right, so
oil prices will plummet now that the 10% of the market Iran has now opened up and will probably remain opened up for a long time because America loves oil, cheap oil. So
it'll probably open up until we all glow in the dark.
All about alternative energy. So, you know, if the market opens up for to get us off our dependence on oil, then I'm all for that, you know. So.
Yeah, because if you do think about this logically, it was last Friday, I believe, one report said that oil barrels have dropped to $49 per barrel, which is really cheap. And then another report actually just came out today stating that we are about to hit a 45-year height in oil production here and supply in general of just oil around the globe. And what it's doing is, you know, in the United States, we can't produce as oil as cheap as Saudi Arabia or Iran, because there you literally stick your thumb in the ground, in the sand, and oil sprouts up. But in America, we have rocky terrain. We use, you know, hydraulic fracking, sideways drilling, things of that nature. It's more expensive to produce the same amount of oil. So what it's doing is it's actually hurting American oil companies. But what it's not doing is hurting American alternative fuel companies, which are going to get a huge boost from this, because we want energy companies that compete with the rest of the world, regardless of what type of energy it is. So I think this is going to be great for alternative energy in the future.
Well, I mean, just because
I think it's going to open up the market too. So, you know,
yeah,
just because of where I live, I think for the short term, we may be in a little bit of trouble. But ultimately, the lower oil prices are going to be better for the economy because it's basically a pay raise.
Yeah, I mean, exactly. you get more consumer spending. More consumer spending leads to bigger corporation spending, the people who I love so much, and then, you know, trickle-down economics, which totally works, then kicks in, all that lovable stuff.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. I mean, because of the job that I do, I've already been talking to people that are there that are starting to be affected by the layoffs from the oil industry, which I think is a bit of a knee-jerk reaction because I know some folks in the oil industry, and they hedge their bets. So right now they're not losing anything because they bet the right way in the futures market. So the money that they're losing in their actual prices, they're making up in the returns from the fact that they hedged their bet in the futures market and actually got it right, which is the other thing that annoys me is because – there are way too many people that are already making way too much money, and then they just want to do nothing but continue to make even more money. I mean, there has to be a natural point where you say, okay, at this point, I've made enough. It's time for me to start giving it back, even if it's pay raises to employees. I mean, that's like the Costco business model. I wish more people would follow that.
Wait. Once you start making enough money, it's time to give it back? You sound like Elizabeth Warren and Bernie Sanders, my friend.
No, that's not – no, it's not the same thing because I'm not saying the government should make them give it back. I'm saying there should be a natural point in someone's conscience where they say, look, I'm making $5 million a year at this point and I can live on one. So why don't we take this other $4 million and start making sure that the folks that are working under me are getting the things that they need to get? I'm not saying the government should do it. I'm saying let the market figure it out because – up until this, I mean, for the longest time, the CEOs were being paid about like the one that's currently running Costco was being paid until the whole Disney debacle happened and all of a sudden they're bringing some fixer in to fix things for 10 times the going rate of any other CEO. And when they saw him getting away with it, all of them decided, well, damn it, if he's getting paid like that, I deserve it too. And no, I'm sorry, you probably don't, because just like in every other business, not all CEOs are created equal.
Regardless of what the motive may be, Rick, you just warmed my heart a little bit.
Yeah.
You need some tongs.
Yeah, it's careful. It's probably actually heartburn.
Speaking of Costco, you mentioned, I heard that they were going to be putting a store here in the Oklahoma City area.
They are working on it, which has me really excited because if we can get that business model in here, Walmart's going to have to either fix some things or go away.
Which Sam's case. Club is going to take a huge hit.
Oh, let me cry a river for them.
Oh, yeah. Well, no, I'm all for it. I moved here from Seattle, so Costco is very popular in my heart.
Let me ask you guys a question. You know, I've recently been – we've been going over this in my economics class, is Walmart bad for America? And before I give my input, let me hear what you guys think about that.
It's a double-edged sword because the fact that Walmart employs a lot of people is good for America. The fact that they choose to do it at a level that basically leaves most of their staff as adults still needing food stamps, I'm kind of on the fence with that because those cashier positions and stuff, they weren't designed to be the whole, you know, raise a family, buy a house, get a car thing. They were for high school students that were just learning how to get jobs and do the things that they needed to do to learn the skills that they needed, and then they were supposed to move on. So, I mean, I can't really fault Walmart, but at the same time, I can say honestly, if it were me and I was in charge of Walmart, I would run it more like what Costco does, not what Walmart does. But since I'm the judge not lest ye be judged type, I can't really throw stones at Walmart for hoarding their money either, because it's their choice. I didn't make the money. I can't make them give it away. I just know I would do it differently if it were me.
Yeah.
I'm kind of on the same path that Ricky's on. I don't like the fact that they're taking business away from local business, but at the same time, if you can't compete, then maybe you need to change your business model. I don't know.
Well, I mean, let's face it. Walmart's not exactly the highest playing above board group when it comes to running mom and pop shops out of the area. They do some shady stuff, and I'm not even going to pretend they don't. But like I said, if it were me, if I was a CEO, I would run things completely differently. Of course, they probably wouldn't be this close to world domination if I was their CEO either.
Hey, can I ask a dumb question?
No such thing. Well, hang on. Let me reserve that. Let me hear it first, and I'll tell you whether or not it's a dumb question.
What show are we on?
Right now, we're still on Finding Common Ground. We never changed gears.
Okay. I couldn't tell if we were on a Off the Rails or not.
No, Off the Rails is a solo show, brother. Okay. Bryce wouldn't be here.
Well, I'm only asking because I'm looking at the website. And
would you stop about the website?
Erica Off the Rails still mentions that we're on. Yeah, the website still says Off the Rails. So
I know what the website says. I don't speak PHP. And every time I keep sending in the updated list, somebody decides they want to move the show.
Okay.
Wonder who that somebody is that I'm talking about now. Huh? Who could that be? Mr. ADHD about the website?
Because you don't even have they don't even have the politatainment stuff on the schedule.
I know, because I just sent him that stuff and he told me he was going to get it put up this week, and now I've got to send him another thing that says, oh, by the way, we got to move the other stuff around and put this guy here too. But he's on vacation this week. That's what I keep trying to tell you guys. He's in Vegas again.
Maybe Bastard. You should teach us PHP then.
Even if I knew how to do it, I don't have access to that part of the website anymore. I don't know what he's done, but he's made it to where all I can do is post stuff. It's kind of disturbing. I think he's afraid I'm going to break it. Okay, anyway, so at this point, we probably really should change gears, Bryce. I'll leave it up to you whether or not we all hang out with you, but we need to go over to your show.
All right, sure, sounds good.
I'm actually going to take off. I've got some things I got to take care of.
All right. Well, you just didn't want to hang out on a liberal show. I know what it was. You're like, nope, not going to do it. Got to go.
No, I actually got a lot of stuff to do today. I've got an important event going on tonight. And
I'm just messing with you. I know. Yeah, I'm going to have a houseful later myself because got nieces and nephews and grandkids coming over to do the whole Easter egg thing for the painting, and then they're staying the night. And I'm just like, I'm going to have a house full of little children. I want to run away. Oh, I'm sorry. Was that out loud? All right. So at this point, we are going to call it quits for this one, folks. We'll be back here in just a couple of minutes with Bryce and Opinion Nation. And then when he's done with that one, we'll finish up your Saturday morning lineup with yours truly, me, myself, and I, ranting and raving and acting crazy as always. Okay, so...
It was a great show.
Huh?
Today was a great show. I enjoyed it.
It was fun. It's been a while.
Take care.
Have a good one.
Bye.
All right, so I'm just going to cue the... All right, folks, that's going to do it for this week's episode of Finding Common Ground. I'm Rick Robinson, joined in studio today by Bryce Robbins. And then, of course, we had Steve Long, host of Liberty Unfiltered, live in call with us, announcing his return to K98Talk.com. Don't forget to tune in and check him out this coming Monday at 8 Eastern, 7 Central, on right after I stop yapping. All right, we'll be right back here in just a minute with Opinion Nation, hosted by Bryce Robbins. You guys have...
On this episode of Storage Wars.
Another day at a rookie don't got no lockers, man. Money owns this town, man, I told you.
Man, today I got no lockers. Last two trips I lost my ass. I'm just about to say screw it. That or I need a mentor or something.
Barack Obama? What are you doing here?
Money owns this town. Money owns this town. Yeah, you know what I'm talking about. Money owns...
Look, as a rookie here, I understand that you're going to have your ups and downs. Recently, I've had a lot more downs. So just imagine my surprise when Barack Obama shows up at the mini-U storage in Santa Ana, California. Mr. President, I can't... Wow, I can't believe you're here. They call me the rookie around here, but it's a pleasure to meet you. What are you doing here?
Well, it's a pleasure to meet you. Let's just say I'm a big fan of the show. And I see you've been struggling. And when it comes to getting a good deal, let's just say I'm uniquely qualified. Figured I'd lend a hand.
Lend a hand? What, like me and you buy lockers together today? I mean, what are you thinking?
I'm game if you are.
Oh, that's awesome. Yeah, of course. Let's do it.
You go through these gates, you need to know the rules. We're going to go to the unit. We're going to remove the locker. We're going to give you 5 minutes to take a look around. You can't go inside. You can't open any boxes. And whoever's got the most money in their pocket can own it today. Are you ready?
Yeah. Yeah, all right. Let's do it.
All right. It sounds like you are. Let's go.
Come on now. Woo!
All right, baby. All right, so check it out. I see like a leather sofa over there, and there's some nice end tables there.
I got to see some golf clubs.
Yeah, I see those back to the Titleist. Yeah, that's a good call, Mr. President. I see those. It's not a bad locker. What do you think? You want to get in on it?
Let's do it.
This locker's a real rookie taker. As in, I'll let a rookie taker.
All right, here we go. Number 20, what are you going to pay? How much? How much? How much? 20, where? 50.
$200,000? It was at $350. We just spent $200,000 on a living room set and a set of golf clubs. Are you serious?
Hey, take it from me. You can never spend too much money on golf. Trust me on that one. Hey, where are you going? What's the big deal? Just print money like I do.
Storage Wars will be back.
K98Talk.com, a leader in internet radio. So grab your seatbelts and take the ride of your life on K98Talk.com. Welcome to Opinion Nation.
And we stand today on the edge of a new frontier.
There is nothing wrong with America that cannot be cured by what is right with America.
What makes us Americans is our shared commitment to an ideal, that all of us are created equal.
I, too, am America.
Now here's your host, Bryce Robbins.
Maybe. Bryce, are you there? not on my end. I don't know what's going on. Apparently we are having a technical difficulty. Give me just one more second here, folks. What is going on, I wonder? Well, I seem to have possibly lost Bryce. Give me just a second. All right, we'll be right back here in just a couple minutes. I'm going to see if I can get this squared away.
Hey everybody, this is Jason, host of According to Me. I'd like to invite you to check out my show. It's a two-hour show that lasts 60 minutes in...
Listen, I hate to interrupt, but one thing I can do is read off a script. Just say, let me be clear a lot. It works.
President Obama, I can handle this. It's a radio promo. I'm not green. I've done this before.
Did someone say green?
Now, Al Gore is here. Listen, I'm just trying to record a radio promo. Do you mind?
Now, do you say good things about me on the show?
No, not at all. But if it makes you feel any better, I rip on Republicans just as much.
The AM radio frequencies give off very high levels of radiation.
Look, my show is on the internet, which you invented. Can I just do my promo?
I got a pen. I can veto that, you know.
I know you got a pen. It's not a law. It's a radio promo. Listen, just listen to my show. Barack Obama and Al Gore hate it, so you're going
to
love it.
Here's an executive order. Don't listen to his show. He doesn't like me. He's racist.
And he doesn't recycle either.
That's it. I'm done. It's According to Me, Wednesdays, 10 p.m. Eastern, right here on K98 Talk.
We're gonna spread happiness. We're gonna spread freedom. Obama's gonna change it. Obama's gonna lead 'em.
So let me be clear. You didn't build that.
Everything he's done is clean as a whistle. He's never not only broken any law, he's never done anything wrong. He's the perfect father, the perfect husband, the perfect American.
Hey, y'all. This is Sam Janney, or the Bunny, as many of you know me by, your friendly neighborhood bad girl of conservatism. Here to talk to you about my show. I'll talk about conservative issues, my top 10 douchebags of the week, and have some pretty badass conservative guests on the show. All that, plus me, your resident bunny with a chainsaw.
Wednesday nights will never be the same. It's Unapologetically Bunny, Wednesdays, 9 p.m. Eastern, right here on K98 Talk.
Welcome to Opinion Nation.
And we stand today on the edge of a new frontier.
There is nothing wrong with America that cannot be cured by what is right with America.
What makes us Americans is our shared commitment to an ideal, that all of us are created equal.
I, too, am America.
Now here's your host, Bryce Robbins.
Hello, everybody, and welcome back. God, it feels good to be back on the radio. If you weren't listening on the last show, Finding Common Ground, I will tell you I've been away. JSA, Junior Statesman of America, it's a club that I do, and I'm currently running for a position, vice mayor. So I've been kind of election season, campaigning every Saturday. That's why I've been gone, and I'll be gone again next week because that's when the election is. And then hopefully the following Saturday I will come back with good news for you all. But I'm glad to be back. I'm glad that, the transition back has been so easy. And I'm so happy to be back on K98. So let's talk. I think we're going to talk about big banks. And then, actually, first we'll talk about something I saw at the Port Authority. If you don't know what the Port Authority is, it is the biggest hub around. It is in New York City. It brings people from New Jersey into New York City. It connects trains. It deals about 250,000 people a day, something like that. It connects all the subways. 42nd Street in New York City. We'll talk about something I saw there. And then from there, we're going to transition into big banks, big corporations, my best friends. All right, so we'll start. The other day, I was at my girlfriend's school. She had an art show gallery thing, and I went and checked it out, and it was amazing. And then I was coming home. And as you all know, I live in New Jersey, so I was going to take the bus home. And as I was walking through the Port Authority, and it wasn't the first time I've seen this, but for whatever reason, it really just, it struck me. I saw a woman walking. She was an African-American woman. She was slouched over. She had to have been at least in her late 40s, maybe 50s. But she had no shoes on, and she looked tattered and a little dirty, and her bare feet were just touching the ground, and these, it just wasn't very nice. And I was thinking to myself, you know, here I am walking through this beautiful, well, what once was beautiful and still a giant port. And there are people in this country who don't even have a pair of shoes to wear. And whether that's because there's something wrong or because, you know, maybe some people like to think that they're lazy, but I don't. But point is that there are so many people in this nation who don't have basic things that, you know, somebody takes for granted that does have those things. And I was just thinking how there are companies in this very country that get millions and billions of dollars in tax breaks. And there was one statistic that showed that that some of the biggest companies in this country are keeping over $1 trillion that would be taxed normally out of this country through overseas banking. We see that there was one statistic that said 1 in 4 corporations isn't paying their federal income taxes properly or what it should be because of tax loopholes. We see that the military is so bloated and inefficient. And although I'm in support of having the world's biggest military, I'm not in support of just blatant inefficiency in the sense that we have the F-35 program, what I think to be a failure, and so do many others. It's been over $100 billion program. We haven't seen one of them protecting an American life or flying to protect Americans. We've seen them fail. We've seen them be hacked by the Chinese. There is something wrong with the priorities in this country. So I see, you know, this woman walking, and I have this revelation of how all these, you know, giant corporations are keeping all their money out of being taxed, how the military is so inefficient and bloated, how we see all this inadequate and just disproportionate spending for where the priorities really should be. You know, in New Jersey, we see, I went into this on one of my last shows, how Governor Chris Christie who settled a lawsuit that was originally for $9 billion for $250 million. Now, he prides this on the fact that it is an endless cap on the cleanup, that, you know, he can get as much money as he wants because there's a clause in the cleanup agreement that they will charge however much it takes to clean the area up. But that's actually from a clause from 1991. You know, John Stewart actually went into that a little bit, but that's besides the point. My point is here is that there are people in this very country who lack what many people feel to be, you know, basic living things. Shoes, for example. Clothing, for example. You know, there was another woman in the Port Authority over the summer. I used to do a program at Cooper Union, a summer program for engineering. And every day I would walk to the 7 train. And on my way to the 7 train, I would see this woman. She was an older Asian woman. She was clearly homeless, and she would squat against the wall every day. And she had a little cup out for change. And I would ask my mom for a bag of Cheerios every day. And I would just go and put them down next to her, and she would smile at me. And just to think that Cheerios could make somebody smile was really a great feeling for me. But my point is not to, you know, gloat about how philanthropic I am. My point is that there are people in this country who genuinely need help. And we need to stop helping these giant bloated corporations. We need to stop funneling money into our military industrial complex, which Dwight D. Eisenhower so gravely warned against. Because it has clearly become profitable to enter into war with all these military contractors, with all these giant industries that funnel money into our military in contracting. You know, in the 1960s, I'm going to do a little history lesson like I love to do. We saw that we were tied down between the Great Society of Lyndon B. Johnson and the Vietnam War. Unfortunately, we chose the Vietnam War. I mean, hindsight's a bitch, but we could clearly see that, you know, maybe we shouldn't have done that. During the arm race during the Cold War, you know, that maybe was necessary during the times, but of course we see the growth of our military. And now, today, although I salute our soldiers, and I think that our operations around the globe are genuinely, well, I think in a lot of cases are, they're built to help people around the globe, but a lot of them have to do with our interests around the globe. But we can see where we are spending a lot of money. And we can see that, you know, corporations are getting a lot of money. And we see that there's a lot of people being left in the dust here. And it's the same people who don't have shoes, who don't have food. And it's those people that I saw at the Port Authority. So, in today's topic, I really want to talk about income inequality. I mean, that is the main topic that is today's show is going to be about. I don't really have much time because I loved talking with Steve and Rick on finding common ground, but maybe I'll run a little bit over the 12 o'clock mark. But I just want to give a little quote from my boy Bernie Sanders. He says, "The rich get richer. Everyone else gets poorer. The wealthiest 8 Americans increased their wealth by more than $87 billion in 2014. That's more than the nation spent on food stamps, which the Republicans want to cut." Now, of course, he mentioned Republicans, and I'm not going to single out Republicans in this, but we can see that there is clearly a problem. Another quote from Bernie Sanders is that, you know, a few wealthy individuals and corporations have bought up our private sector, and now they're building up the government. Campaign finance reform is the most important issue facing us today, because it impacts all the others. And I think that's really true. But we'll get to that. We'll get to so much more. But let's just focus on the idea of income inequality. Is that in the 1970s, and whether you agree with him or not, he's a brilliant guy, Robert Reich. He's got an IQ off the charts. Even though he's small in stature, he's a very smart man. He talks about a vicious cycle. I'm actually going to pull it up so I can quote it for you guys. Let's see if I can get it right quick. Vicious cycle. Okay. So in Robert Reich's Vicious Cycle, he talks about how it all starts with union busting. And we see when unions get busted, as they did in the 1970s, well, then that's bad. You see, what happened was I was actually having this discussion before. The phrase, a woman's place is in the home. Now, whether or not you agree with gender roles or not, that was largely the case up until World War II, when women were in the home and their men went off to war and then they went to the factories. Now, many people don't like to agree with this, but when the men came back, the women immediately left the workplace, going right back to where they were before. It was those children that grew up in that era who saw their mothers going off to work and said, you know, we can be independent too. And somewhere in the 1970s, we saw wages start to stagnate. We saw unions beginning to be busted. And we see that women didn't just go back to work because their mothers were workers and they felt empowered. We saw them going back to work because wages had stagnated. And they needed to go back to work to keep up the life that they lived in the 1950s, the white picket fence, the two-car garage, and the beautiful house. What we saw was that production was continuing to grow at the same pace, but wages continued to stagnate. And from that, we saw workers were buying less. And if workers were buying less, and I'm following his vicious cycles, he says companies will then downsize. If companies then downsize, tax revenues decrease. When tax revenues decrease, the government cuts programs. When government cuts programs, workers are less educated. When workers are less educated, unemployment rises. And then ultimately, deficit grows. And then we are back at the vicious cycle to start all over again. And whether you agree with Robert Reich, because he is, like me and Bernie Sanders, pretty, you know, socialist, but that's besides the point, is he does give this vicious cycle, and it really, really makes sense that we see right now that wages are stagnated, and they haven't grown a whole lot, and that they grew 0.4%, and the whole media went crazy. This wasn't enough wage growth, but it was a start. But what we can see is that we really need to impact the way this country prioritizes how it spends. Because I really believe we need better Head Start education for young children, and I'm talking preschoolers. And I think that's what the government needs to spend money on. Bernie Sanders actually gave this quote. He was talking about, and I'm paraphrasing here because I don't have the quote in front of me, but he was saying, you know, what a good society would look like is where children can get into college education without going into debt, and senior citizens can get health care without having no money left over for their children when they leave this earth. You know, people will call me a socialist because I believe that everybody should have health care. And people call me a socialist because I believe that, you know, state education should be free. Well, at one point, state education was free. If I wanted to go to, you know, if I lived in California, I wanted to go to UC Berkeley, that was free. If I wanted to go to Rutgers, that was free. Or it came at a very, very low cost starting in the 1960s. Now, you know, I'm going to be in debt until I'm 55 paying off college loans because I want to go to a good school where I can get a good head start. But I really don't think these are socialist policies. I just believe that we do need to redistribute wealth from where it is. And I know that's kind of borderline, you know, that is the definition of socialist, is basically redistributing wealth so that everybody has, you know, their fair share of stuff. But it's no longer a fair share, okay? There's a very, very rich percent. And I believe it was 95% of income growth in 2014 went to the top 5%. So we see that it's not even fair anymore, that the rich are getting very, very rich and the poor are staying in the same spot. Wages are stagnating. The middle class is shrinking. There needs to be something that bridges this gap, that really fixes the problem. To me, I believe in workfare, and I believe that we need a, you know, a WPA, a Tennessee Valley Authority again. I think that's just basically the only way to go. All right, so I'm going to go take a quick break, but when I come back, we're going to talk more about big corporations and what we can do, or what we can, what the idea, my mindset is on how we can stop big corporations from, you know, stomping all over the little guy. All right, let's go to break. Be right back.
We're gonna spread happiness. We're gonna spread freedom. Obama's gonna change it. Obama's gonna lead 'em.
So let me be clear. You didn't build that.
Everything he's done is clean as a whistle. He's never not only broken any law, he's never done anything wrong. He's the perfect father, the perfect husband, the perfect American.
Hey y'all, this is Sam Janney, or the Bunny as many of you know me by, your friendly neighborhood bad girl of conservatism. Here to talk to you about my show. I'll talk about conservative issues, my top 10 douchebags of the week, and have some pretty badass conservative guests on the show. All that, plus me, your resident Bunny with a chainsaw.
Wednesday nights will never be the same. It's Unapologetically Bunny, Wednesdays, 9 p.m. Eastern, right here on K98 Talk.
Hey everybody, this is Jason, host of According to Me. I'd like to invite you to check out my show.
It's a two-hour show that lasts 60 minutes in.
Listen, I hate to interrupt, but one thing I can do is read off a script. Just say, let me be clear a lot. It works.
President Obama, I can handle this. It's a radio promo. I'm not green. I've done this before.
Did someone say green?
Now, Al Gore is here. Listen, I'm just trying to record a radio promo. Do you mind?
Now, do you say good things about me on the show?
No, not at all. But if it makes you feel any better, I rip on Republicans just as much.
The AM radio frequencies give off very high levels of radiation.
Look, my show is on the internet, which you invented. Can I just do my promo?
I got a pen. I can veto that, you know.
I know you got a pen. It's not a law. It's a radio promo. Listen, just listen to my show. Barack Obama and Al Gore hate it, so you're going
to
love it.
Here's an executive order. Don't listen to his show. He doesn't like me. He's racist.
And he doesn't recycle either.
That's it. I'm done. It's According to Me, Wednesdays, 10 p.m. Eastern, right here on K98 Talk.
This is Misty, owner of Wax It Studio in Edmond, Oklahoma, and I'm here to talk to you about a skincare product called Theramedics. Theramedics has a wonderful line of products from anti-aging to hyperpigmentations all the way to acne. In fact, everyone at some point in our life is affected by acne. Acne can cause a great deal of embarrassment and anxiety. And in order to prevent and help other people, I have tapped into this wonderful product called Theramedics. Visit my website at www.prettyskindeep.com. Again, that's www.prettyskindeep.com. And I'm pretty, the vicious thing, and you're thinking jump another visit. I get stupid mind, it's all the same as ain't living there, but I don't get it. The vicious thing, if it's wicked, put it on credit. The vicious thing, if you're thinking jump another visit.
Bryce.
Oh, hey guys, I'm sorry. All right, I'm back. My bad. Zoned out reading a Teddy Roosevelt quote here. My fault. All right. So now that we're back and we're going to, I promise we're going to talk about big banks. All right. So I don't know how many people have ever seen Wall Street, ever been to Wall Street, seen the Golden Bull, but Wall Street really is gilded, I would put it. It's a cheap covering. You know, the Gilded Age was a time of great wealth and growth, but it was also a pretty bad time for the average Joe in America. The Gilded Age was based around, a cheap covering, a cover-up. What looked great was actually not so great. And I feel that that's what Wall Street is, exactly what Wall Street portrays. It's something that looks great. We see the stock market explodes. We see Wall Street is doing great, but the average Joe is not. And that just seems what's happening in America at this time, is that Wall Street is doing phenomenal. Stock market keeps breaking new highs. But what we don't realize is that the big banks in America get subsidized $83 billion each year. A big problem is that we are not doing enough to repair the banks, even years after they've hurt our people. Let's not forget the bank bailouts, the banking crisis. Why did the banking crisis happen? I can explain it. I explained it pretty easily to my friend the other day. I mean, this is obviously just an overview, but banks were doing risky trading. Risky trading is essentially, they took investors' money, they took retirement funds, they took people who gave them their money. That money pooled into their banks, and they then took that money. And when somebody came for a loan for their home or mortgage for their home, they said, here, take this money. Handed off the retirement, the investment money, handed that off to people who had wanted loans. Those loans, well, they weren't vetted properly. The people could not afford their loans eventually. And when the people who initially invested their money wanted it back, the money wasn't there. Banks then closed. Banks were going bust. The housing bubble popped. And I feel, and so does Elizabeth Warren, and I think this is just a general consensus around the board, that the next bubble to pop is going to be in student loan debt. My biggest problem here is that if we really want to live in a capitalist society, then we wouldn't have bailed out the banks. But we did. because they were too big to fail. And here's where capitalism fails. Because don't get me wrong, I do like capitalism, because the ultimate beneficiary is we the people. That when we have companies like Samsung and Apple going head-to-head with each other, they are motivated to create a better product for the consumer, which is we the people. And that's why my Samsung is water-resistant, and that's why the iPhone has an amazing screen display. That's why the new Galaxy is going to be, you know, OLED or whatever. And ultimately, we see progress of improving products because that's what the market demands. But what the market doesn't account for is that there are people who take advantage of the system put in place. And that's where the whole financial reform moves into this conversation that Bernie Sanders brings up. The biggest problem today that we face is, well, normally I would say climate change, but today you can also argue that it's financial reform, election campaign finance reform on Wall Street. Campaign finance reform in our government. Because we see Wall Street playing a big hand in our politics. Now, we see this could be a big problem because the interests of Wall Street are the interests of few, looking to make billions upon billions of dollars off crappy deals for the American people. We see Dodd-Frank got a little stripped this year. Now, what Dodd-Frank did was, well, it did its best job at, you know, healing the banks from committing such acts again against the American people, from risky trading. We saw that Glass-Steagall was replaced, and Glass-Steagall divided the banks, made it, you have your risky trading part that you can do with your own money, but here's the people's money's account, and you can't touch that. Of course, these are simplifications of what the legislation is, but I encourage you to read these pieces of legislation. They're very well written, very long. But ultimately, what makes sense for the average American is not being echoed in our government, where we need protection from these giant banks who are hurting us and the economy. We are not getting protection because it's those same people who are funding the campaigns of our current politicians. And that's no exemption from Obama and Hillary Clinton. In fact, Obama was one of the biggest beneficiaries of Goldman Sachs. So was Mitt Romney. Our politicians are being drenched with funding coming in from big banks, big corporations. And what that does is it basically puts their agenda as the agenda of the politician. And that's where we get a result of the TPP, or Fast Track, the Trans-Pacific Partnership, which is going to not service the American people, but going to service big corporations. You want to know why I love Elizabeth Warren so much is because, well, I see the angle that she's coming at. She's really a politician who didn't win on the backs of big corporations, big money politicians. What sets her aside from Barack Obama and all the rest is that she is really somebody who gets the problem that faces Americans. You read her biography. I actually read her book. It was a great, great read. She didn't grow up from much money, but the National Defense of Education Act helped her attend college. She was able to go to school, get an education, and she became a teacher. And now, look where she is today. Now, to me, that's the American dream, where you can live in a country, you can come from little, and even if the government helps you and makes you as successful as her, well, then the government did its job, and you did your job as a citizen. But the thing is, the National Defense of Education Act was put in as a social program against the Soviet Union to increase education. That is an example of legislation for the people, rather than, you know, fast track TPP style legislation that is simply for the big corporations. Now, Elizabeth Warren came up and then she became a politician as she is today, and she fights for student loan debt, refinancing student loan debt so that it's not 7-8%, it's around more like 3%. She's also fighting to bail out student loan debt. Because we bail out big banks, but we won't bail out students. And although there's an argument why we shouldn't do that, there's no excuse for our government to be making money off of student loan debt to pay off other debt. It is outrageous and ridiculous. Additionally, Elizabeth Warren just seems to be a person for the people rather than a person for a corporation. although I don't necessarily agree with Elizabeth Warren on a lot of things, in fact, she's against nuclear power, and we all know that I'm the only environmentalist, or I'm a rarity that I'm an environmentalist who prides themselves on that, but I'm pro-nuclear power. Yes, I am. I love nuclear power. But the point is that, like Elizabeth Warren, we cannot deny that there is a problem with big corporations in this country, that they're oversized and they don't take care of their people. And we must call upon our government and elected officials to realize that we put them in office. Ultimately, my biggest point here is this, that we elect government officials to write laws in this representative democracy. We're not electing them to represent corporations, and corporations are not electing them. They're not voting for them. So the notion that corporations are people too should be completely thrown out the window. We don't have to agree with everything that the Supreme Court says. I mean, I know I don't, and I hope that many of you realize that as well. But what we must realize here is that big corporations these days, they're not, I'm not saying that they're bad, because they do give us great stuff. But we have a problem with greed in this country, and it is sickening. The fact that somebody, some CEO, is making billions of dollars, that they can't even keep all their money in a bank, that they have to keep it circulating in the stock market because it's so much freaking money, and there's a woman walking around the Port Authority without shoes, or there's somebody else who doesn't have, you know, food, or that there's 2,500 people right now in Baltimore who are losing water every single week because they can't afford it. And you're going to tell me that we should be funding and subsidizing big banks, corporations, the military, and these horrible trade agreements that are going to be hurting American jobs? Something is wrong there. Something's horribly wrong. Now, here's another little statistic to throw at you. It wasn't until a couple weeks ago that Walmart raised its minimum wage to $10.10 an hour, which will be effective, I believe, in a couple months. But Rick touched upon it a little bit in the last show, that minimum wage jobs were never meant for the average Joe. They were meant for teenagers who were looking to start off in the workplace. But now more and more we're seeing college graduates either going home, sleeping on the couch and waking up to go to, you know, work at CVS. We're not seeing them go off to their, you know, what used to be a good job. We're seeing that people need help these days. We need to improve education. We need to help college debt by stopping it, because that is holding us back. And we need to stop corporations from writing our laws. In fact, there have been several laws that have just been literally written, copied and pasted by Citibank, Citigroup. For example, the Trans-Pacific Partnership is a literal copy and paste of a previous trade agreement that was proposed by the Citigroup. Ultimately, people really feel like the system is rigged against them. And they're right. The system is rigged. The system is rigged against them, that the big banks have the upper advantage. That this is not a country by the people for the people anymore. It is a country by the corporation for the corporation, is what it seems. And what we really need to do is send a message to Washington that this is unacceptable. My feeling here is that it's greed. People are so greedy that it's more like, if I make a million, let me make a billion. And if I make a billion, then I'll make a zillion. And if I make a zillion, then I'll make a gajillion. And I know I skipped trillion there. I just kind of realized that. Point being made, there is no excuse for somebody in this country to be walking around without shoes, with people going without water, people going without food, people being taken off food stamps, when some company like the Koch brothers or whatever is getting millions and millions and billions of dollars in tax breaks, when the military is blowing its money on failed programs, when we're signing away trade deals that are literally going to be destroying thousands, if not hundreds of thousands, if not millions of American jobs. There's something wrong here. And that's something that I believe Elizabeth Warren proposes differently, that she has the power to fix these things because she has that mindset. She's not funded by the corporations. And that's where I differ with Scott Walker. So let's jump a little bit to 2016 here, when Scott Walker is obviously going to be running for office. You know, here's the big problem. Here's the big problem, is that Scott Walker, governor of Wisconsin, is clearly funded by the corporations, explicitly the Koch brothers. In his recall election, he was given over $2 million by the Koch brothers. Now, they don't even live in Wisconsin, but they have 6 paper companies and 2 oil pipelines that run through the state. You wonder why they're funding them so much, and they're pressing him to destroy unions and collective bargaining, is because they have so many employees there. That now they're going to get to increase their funds for their or their profit. We need to stop focusing our legislation on certain people making profit. Rather, how can society profit as a whole? Now, I want this to kind of be a place for discussion, where I really want to hear your opinions on this. So I encourage you to all tweet me at OPNAT News. Go on Facebook and message me or post at me at Opinion Nation News. Or even just join the message board on the K98 Talk website. But let's talk here. What is the problem about taxing the rich and giving back to those less fortunate? Now, I use my words carefully there, then, rather than saying, you know, give to the poor. Because can we really call them poor if they're just low-income people who literally can't move up? Because social mobility is so difficult at this point, because the system is rigged against them. We don't really see as often somebody coming from low income making it to be such a success story without the help of government, or government passing legislation for the people, as was Elizabeth Warren with the National Defense of Education Act, as was my grandfather, who literally came from nothing, immigrant from Canada, poor as can be. But he was assisted when he came back on the GI Bill, attended Queens College for free, and became a successful businessman. That is an example of the government passing legislation for the people. And I really feel that social reform is needed, where we expand Medicare, Medicaid. We don't make it into a voucher program. Where we expand access to healthcare, but actually make it work. The problem with Obamacare that nobody really seems to bring to light enough is not that, you know, why should I pay for healthcare that I don't want, or why should I pay for some Joe Schmo's healthcare? The problem is this. It is a copy and paste of what the big healthcare companies want. The fact that, you know, 14 million more people just signed up for healthcare. Great. I mean, that's great that they're going to get healthcare. Here's the problem. We just signed up 14 million more customers for the big healthcare industries that profit billions upon billions of dollars on this healthcare agreement. The Affordable Care Act is good if you want to look at it from the outside. But the true fact of the matter is that you didn't make a healthcare system for the people. You didn't make it easier to go see a doctor. You didn't make it easier to go get a healthcare checkup. You didn't make it easier for anybody. All you did was subsidize their visits and, you know, subsequently gave billions of dollars to these already humongous healthcare corporations that make billions of dollars in profit. Their CEOs walk away with gajillions of dollars. And it seems that if you walk into a doctor's office, you know, you're waiting hours, and it's really become for the insurance companies, not for the patient anymore. So that's where I go off on the Affordable Care Act. Now, I'm not going to read 2,000 pages worth of garbage to find out that it's simply copy and pasted from all these, you know, giant healthcare corporations. But it's clear that it's just a scam to get more customers. We need healthcare that's actually for the people. That, you know, I genuinely believe in state exchanges. But with the Canadian, you pay it forward system, where you're paying your healthcare forward. Because what is it? It's like 75% of healthcare costs come at the age of 80 and above. So you pay it forward. You pay it forward from the start. And that's how I think we should be going and looking at this. I mean, we are cutting back from Social Security because we accuse it of being the problem. And it seems that that's a quick fix when we say, oh, Social Security is going to bankrupt the country. You look at how much this country spends. Social Security is an eensy, bincy, tiny amount. And let's not forget, it hasn't contributed an ounce to public debt because it's a public trust. It's simply people paying it forward. The problem with it is that we have the baby boomers who are all getting old and dying and getting sick. And they didn't, and you know, they didn't have as much kids. So now we are stuck to pay with it. And, well, we don't have that kind of money. That's the problem with Social Security. But cutting it isn't the right way to go. Reforming it to make it work, that's the way to go. You know, I look at all these social programs, and you can argue that, you know, Social Security wasn't meant to last long, that Medicare and Medicaid weren't meant to be in place for as long as they have been. But the fact of the matter is that they work, or they attempt at working, and they do a pretty good job at it. And then when the government works for the people, it is something that just seems to really, really, really work. It seems that when we enable our people rather than enable corporations to make profit, we do something that's great for our country altogether. It seems that the big way to fix this country is when you take care of the people, because that's when we all prosper. But when we take care of the big corporations, they prosper like crazy. The politicians get funded like crazy. So it's a greater fix for them. It's the best deal that they can get. It's not the best deal for Americans. You know, if Wall Street can borrow money, this is a quote from Elizabeth Warren, if Wall Street can borrow money at 0.75% interest, students should be able to as well. But of course they don't, because we don't fund students, because we don't look at that as profitable, because it's an investment on long term. On the long term. But we're not looking at it as if, if you look at some giant Fortune 500 company, in 2 seconds they'll make billions of dollars and they'll fund some campaign and they'll build some giant, you know, complex pipeline, whatever. And that suddenly will, make it all okay. Here's the biggest problems that we're facing right now, is that corporations are treated as people, and that they're making so much flipping money, and their policy today is going in their flipping way, that we're forgetting about the true American, the, you know, Joe Dirt, you know, get up and go to work kind of guy. That's who we're forgetting about, and that's the biggest problem. We look down upon the people who want to become plumbers and electricians these days, and we glorify those who want to go to some big giant school who becomes, you know, some freaky deaky African American studies major. There's a lot of problems with our priorities these days. But what we're not doing these days is enabling our people as we used to. It feels, or what it seems like, is that policy used to be based around, how can we enable growth among our people? And it really seemed to be that way in the 1950s, 60s, the glorious 30 years following the following World War II. And then all that got sidetracked after Vietnam. And after Vietnam, obviously, we moved, we had the first Iraq War, the second Iraq War, now we're in the war on terror. It's taking away billions of trillions of dollars. We have the war on drugs that's taking away $400 billion, all unsuccessful, all not doing their job. It's all inefficient, and it doesn't help us, really. It doesn't help the average American. It looks good in the newspaper. It looks good on a politician's resume. But ultimately, what are we doing to help next generation of people? Because one day when, you know, the teenagers of today wake up and they're, you know, 25, 30 years old. And when their kids wake up when they're 25 and 30 years old, and they look back and say, you know, what did the previous generation do to help me out? How is society better because of what the previous generation did? I think that we're going to look back and we're going to say, we didn't do much, or we didn't do as much as we could. We didn't really dig deep enough to help out the people of America, to enable the people of America. We didn't put forward the proper policy that would ensure a better future. Case in point is the Trans-Pacific Partnership. It's going to make an overseas court that can sue America, the American government, and governments all around the country because it infringes on corporations' profit. What? I mean, come on. That means that the Beijing-based, you know, coal company feels that their profits are being discriminated against because, you know, New York doesn't want a coal vicinity or closes down their coal-fired power plants. They can technically sue our government because, you know, they're infringing on our profits and their right to be there. To me, that just doesn't seem like it's enabling our people to do great things. To me, that just seems like we're destroying the chance for Americans to grow. Here's an additional one from the Trans-Pacific Partnership, is that, well, it's clearly going to be shipping away American jobs. If you look at how the tariffs roll out and you look at all these things in regard to wages or where basically where production will come from, it's going to be ruining American jobs because we can't compete with that cheap labor in Asia. That's just wrong. That is modern-day slavery. But that's greed for you. I'm talking to you right now through a Apple computer on a Samsung. And of course I'm guilty of it, but so are all of us. And that is literally, we are like the North, and China is like the South, and they're making our cotton, which is our technology, and we are literally just prospering with it, saying, oh, I love this stuff. But you know what? It's freaking slavery. Okay, they're working in sweatshops, they're freaking killing themselves. They have to add, like, suicide nets so they don't kill themselves out of their factories. They get paid, like, 35 cents a day. But this is what capitalism is doing to us right now. Is we are so overgrown with greed that there are people in this world, let alone this country, who don't have an adequate supply of food, nutrition, water, who can't get an education, who don't have access to the internet, who... You know, the list goes on, who don't have shoes, like I pointed out before. But it's okay because, you know, Citibank is getting $83 billion a year in subsidies. That they can borrow interest at 0.75%. It's time we stand up to big banks and big corporations. It's time that we stop cowering in fear to politicians who support them. Or it's time that we just genuinely stop funneling money. It's time that we get our priorities straight. People we should care about are the people who need help. We need to stop looking at Americans who need assistance as lazy, as people who are taking. We need to, a good lyric from, what's his name? Neil Young's song. He goes, we should starve the takers and feed the givers. And what he means by that is starve these takers of wealth in our country and give back to the people who actually give to society. I mean, Chris Christie was just actually at one of those giant food corporations talking, you know, obviously trying to get money for his campaign. And it kind of grosses me out, the fact that these giant chemical food companies get so much money from the government. These food farming bills give them so much money to produce all these freaking mutant crops that will promise you are going to give us cancer. And that's okay. For whatever reason, that's okay. That they can get subsidized and make freaking mutant corn and soy product. But there's somebody in this country who's going to be in debt till they're 55 because they wanted to go to college. Or there's somebody who literally doesn't have a place to sleep tonight, but it's okay because, you know, the billionaires and millionaires at, you know, Cigna Foods or at Monsanto, well, don't worry, they're going to get a good night's sleep tonight in their gajillion-dollar home while they funnel mutant crops down our throat. There's a big problem in America. We really don't have our priorities straight. We really are a country today, at least, that is by the corporation for the corporation, not by the people for the people. I know that Rick and I disagree a lot. and I think a lot of conservatives, and I will disagree a lot, on the interpretation of the Constitution, the interpretation of our founding fathers and what they wanted to set this country up to be like. But what we can agree on is that, you know, the Constitution was meant to protect people's rights from government overreach. It wasn't to protect corporations from government overreach, and it wasn't to protect corporations from losing profit. You know, it just seems so wrong that in today's day and age that some giant corporation or some giant company is getting all these billions of dollars, but someone doesn't have shoes. I'm sorry if I've been rambling and going on rants this whole episode, but it really just, I don't know if it bothers everybody else as much as it bothers me, but that the fact that, you know, it cost $100,000 to get a first flight education in this country, the median household income is $50,000, you know, good luck with that. Everyone in this country says get an education, but, you know, good luck paying for it. Because where are you going to get those loans from? Those loans from? From the same government that profits off you being in debt. The same government that was elected by Wall Street funding them, pouring billions of dollars into the legislature, getting laws passed left and right that profit for them, not for us. So I think that today we should wage war. I don't necessarily love Lyndon B. Johnson, but he did have a good quote, and I want to pull up a direct quote because I think it's great. So bear with me here as I try to pull up this quote. I believe it is, hang on, LBJ, War on Poverty quote. It's a great quote. Here, there we go. This administration here and now declares an unconditional war on poverty. Now, although I think he got sidetracked by the Vietnam War, I think that what that quote stands for should be the motto of every single administration to come, that nobody in this country should be without food, that won't give them freaking cancer, without water, that doesn't have, you know, fracking solution in it, with shoes that, you know, maybe weren't made by Chinese slaves. But ultimately, that nobody should be living in poverty in this country when some freaking corporation is making a gajillion dollars in tax breaks and tax loopholes and by cheating the American people out of money that should be there. Again, I gave this quote in the beginning that there's $1 trillion being held away from Americans. And I just want to kind of sum this whole episode up with a quote from Ronald Reagan, because although I'm a liberal, I gotta say, and I barely agree with this guy on a lot of things, but he's a great speaker. That's why he's a great orator. Poverty won in part because instead of helping the poor, government programs rupture the bonds holding poor families together. He talks about how government programs ended up hurting the poor. And I agree with him. Government programs do, a lot, in a sense, hurt the poor, especially the Affordable Care Act, because it raises premiums and it, you know, it inevitably just makes them customers to giant corporations who write the laws that end up hurting the poor in the end. But there's another great thing that we should all take away from this episode. One second, actually. Is that we think of America as this prosperous nation where you can make it in this country if you work hard. But what it seems inevitably is that the people writing the laws funded by corporations are making it harder and harder to do that. That they're shipping our opportunity overseas. And subsequently, it hurts the American people. So, today's episode has really been about income inequality, about income inequality, about poverty in America, about how it is just genuinely makes sense to help those who need help. In a lot of instances, to quote Ronald Reagan one more time, government is not the solution to our problem. Government is the problem. Yeah, you know what? He's right. I don't know if he's right in the sense that he was talking about, but the reason that government is the problem is because government isn't for, by and for the people. It's by and for the corporation. So I'll leave you with that. Well, it's great to be back. I wish me luck on my election next week. I'll try to call in, stop by real quick and say hi. But ultimately, I love being here on K98 Talk. I know I'm very left, but I'm glad that I have a good amount of followers and listening. And it's really an honor to get to come before everybody Saturday mornings, bang out my thoughts, release my buildup of anger throughout the week, and kind of just let it all out. And I'm glad that I have a lot of people listening in, and, you know, I've had a lot of responses on the Twitter page and Facebook page. So, you know, tweet me at OPNATnews, post at me, or, you know, message me at Opinion Nation News. You can also tweet me at Robbins Bryce. I will see you guys all soon, and just this week, if you see somebody who has less income than you, or you see somebody who has a lot more income than you, or if you just see how the military is ginormous, how food companies have gajillions of dollars, just think about how the distribution of wealth in this country is not prioritized in the way that perhaps it should be. All right, Rick, if you can do as you always do, please take us out.
All right, folks, that's going to do it for this episode of Opinion Nation starring Mr. Bryce Robbins. Glad to have you back with us, sir. Good luck, but no matter what happens next week, I am not referring to you as Mr. Vice Mayor. Just saying.
Not a problem.
All right. So we are going to take a quick break. Then we'll be right back, changing gears to change over to yours truly, ranting and raving as always right here on K98Talk.com. Coming up next, America Off the Rails. You guys enjoy the rest of your Saturday. Thanks to everybody who's tuning in. We'll be right back here in just a minute, and we'll finish off the Saturday right with my show. So, yeah, we go center, left. Then, of course, to do everything correctly, we finish off the Saturday going right. Sorry. Had to take that shot, Bryce. All right. We're out for the moment, folks. We'll be right back, changing gears over to yours truly.
And now, Barack Obama shows us how to negotiate. Lesson one, shopping for that new car.
President Obama, I got to say thank you for meeting me here. I mean, I feel kind of overwhelmed. I'm not really good at negotiating.
No problem. That's what I'm here for. So what kind of car are you looking at?
It's that Cadillac CTS over there. Look, it's a beautiful car, but I mean, the guy told me like the most they'll go down is like $1,000 below sticker price. That's nuts. No way I'm paying that.
Well, let's just say I used to own GM, if you know what I mean. So, pretty sure I can get us a good deal.
Hey, guys, how you doing? Anything in particular you're looking for today? Oh, hey, Mr. President, how are you? Paul, it's a privilege. Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you as well. My friend and I here want to get a price on this Cadillac. And let me just say, as a guy who used to own this company, I expect a good deal.
Yeah, I'll see what I can do for you guys, of course, absolutely.
Right now, we're willing to make you an offer of $62,000 on that Cadillac.
What are you doing?
I got this.
And Mr. President, you know, I mean, we appreciate the offer, $62,000, but, I mean, the sticker price is $55,000.
You just offered him $7,000 over the sticker price. That was too much as it is. What are you...
Hey, who's doing the negotiation here?
You are, I guess. Whatever.
Listen, I'm running out of patience here. I'm going to draw a red line. $65,000, that's it. Actually, forget that. It's time to play hardball. Fine, $70,000.
Are you nuts?
Listen, I got him right where I want him. Since it sounds, Paul, like you're not taking this offer seriously, why don't you get your manager?
I'll get my sales manager. Hold on a second.
So, what have you learned so far?
I've learned that unless you're negotiating with Republicans in Congress, you're awful at this. I'm out of here.
Fine, suit yourself. But I'm pretty sure I could have talked him down to a 17% interest rate. Hey, how much you want for the upgraded floor mats?
Join us next time for even more tips on how to negotiate like a pro with Barack Obama.
K98 Talk is expanding its lineup for 2015. This means we are expanding our advertising base. Whether you're a startup trying to push through to the next level, or an established business trying to supplement your advertising budget, web-based advertising is a solid investment. Thanks to Talk's newest partnership with TuneIn Radio and instant access to our sister station, K98 FM, we give you worldwide access at a reasonable cost. Interested parties should email us at sales@k98fm.com. K98talk.com, a leader in internet radio. So grab your seatbelts and take the ride of your life on K98talk.com.
We will keep this promise to the American people. If you like your doctor, you will be able to keep your doctor, period. If you like your health care plan, you'll be able to keep your health care plan, period.
This is the most transparent administration in history. Not even a smidgen of corruption.
Fact is, we had four dead Americans. What difference at this point does it make?
If you got a business, you didn't build that.
Oh, welcome to the face. Welcome to the face of the new democracy. Come expect just to admit a mistake.
It's time to hear the truth about America's biggest challenges. You're listening to America Off the Rails with your host, Rick Robinson.
All right, folks, we're back. We're live. K98talk.com, Rick Robinson, America Off the Rails. Do hope you guys are having a great Saturday. Thanks to everybody who's tuning in. Hope you've enjoyed the slightly extended edition of Finding Common Ground. And then, of course, Opinion Nation with Bryce Robbins. And now we're going to, of course, finish off your Saturday with yours truly. This is going to kind of be a continuation of a few things that have come up on previous shows. Also, a discussion from today, because I'm going to play a clip that I've played before. And then we're going to talk about it in a completely different direction. So bear with me for just a second while we get that queued up. And then we're just going to go ahead and take off running today. Because we did get a late start and ran long on one of the shows. I'm going to try to do as close to a full hour as I can. But I usually have to be wrapped up pretty close to noon. So we're going to try to cram in as much as we can today and see how far we can get. Except I can't get the board to cooperate with me. Go figure. All right, here we go.
Joining us. Was it a mistake to sign this law?
Thanks for the opportunity.
So was it a mistake to sign this law?
Absolutely not. The Religious Freedom Restoration Act was signed into federal law by President Bill Clinton more than 20 years ago, and it lays out a framework for ensuring that a very high level of scrutiny is given anytime government action impinges on the religious liberty of any American. After that, some 19 states followed that, adopted that statute, and after last year's Hobby Lobby case, Indiana properly brought the same version that then State Senator Barack Obama voted for in Illinois before our legislature. And I was proud to sign it into law last week. But look, I think I understand that there's been a tremendous amount of misinformation and misunderstanding around this bill. And I'm just determined, and I appreciate the time on your program, I'm just determined to clarify this. Well, this is about protecting the religious liberty of people of faith and families of faith across this country. That's what it's been for more than 20 years, and that's what it is now as the law in Indiana, George.
But I think one of the problems that people have pointed out is that in Indiana, your civil rights laws don't include sexual orientation as a protected class. And even some of the supporters of the bill who appeared with you when you signed the bill, Eric Miller of Advance America, wrote that it will protect those who oppose gay marriage. He put up this example. He said, Christian bakers, florists, and photographers should not be punished for refusing to participate in a homosexual marriage. So this is a yes or no question. Is Advance America right when they say a florist in Indiana can now refuse to serve a gay couple without fear of punishment?
Well, let me explain to you. The purpose of this bill is to empower, and has been for more than 20 years, George. This is not speculative. The purpose of this legislation, which is the law in all 50 states in our federal courts, and it's the law by either statute or court decisions in some 30 other states, is very simply to empower individuals when they believe that actions of government impinge on their constitutional First Amendment freedom of religion. And frankly, George, there's a lot of people across this country who you're looking at Obamacare and the Hobby Lobby decision, looking at other cases, who feel that their religious liberty is being infringed upon. And the Religious Freedom Restoration Act at the federal level, and all the states now, including Indiana, who have it, are simply about addressing that. This is not about discrimination. This is about empowering people.
But let me try to pin you,
government
try to pin
overreach,
you down
George.
There, though, on it, because your supporters say it would. And so yes or no, if a florist in Indiana refuses to serve a gay couple at their wedding, is that legal now in Indiana?
George, this is where this debate has gone with misinformation and frankly,
it's just a question, sir. Yes
so,
or no?
Well, there's been shameless rhetoric about my state and about this law and about its intention all over the internet. People are trying to make it about one particular issue, and now you're doing that as well. The issue here, the Religious Freedom Restoration Act has been on the books for more than 20 years. It does not apply, George, to disputes between individuals unless government action is involved. And in point of fact, in more than two decades, the Religious Freedom Restoration Act has never been used to undermine anti-discrimination laws in this country.
Sir, I'm just bringing
the
up a
question,
message from
I
one
think
of
the
your
real
supporters. That
here.
Was one of your supporters who was talking about the bill right there. It said it would protect a Christian florist who against any kind of punishment. Is that true or not?
George, look, the issue here is, you know, is tolerance a two-way street or not? I mean, you know, there's a lot of talk about tolerance in this country today having to do with people on the left. But here Indiana steps forward to protect the constitutional rights and privileges of freedom of religion for people of faith and families of faith in our state. And this avalanche of intolerance that's been poured on our state is just outrageous. You've been to Indiana a bunch of times. You know it. There are no kinder, more generous, more welcoming, more hospitable people in America than in the 92 counties of Indiana. And yet, because we simply stepped forward for the purpose of recognizing the religious liberty rights of all the people of Indiana, of every faith, we suffered under this avalanche for the last several days of condemnation, and it's completely baseless. It's
Governor,
not based on any fact whatsoever.
I completely agree with you about the good people.
But I think people are getting tired of it, George. I really do.
Perhaps.
Tolerance is a two-way street.
So when you say tolerance is a two-way street, does that mean that Christians who want to refuse service, or people of any other faith who want to refuse service to gays and lesbians, that it's now legal in the state of Indiana? That's a simple yes or no question.
George, the question here is if there is a government action or a law that an individual believes impinges on their religious liberty, they have the opportunity to go to court, just as the Religious Freedom Restoration Act that Bill Clinton signed allowed them, go to court, and the court would evaluate the circumstance under the standards articulated in this act. That's all it is. And when you see these headlines about Indiana, the license to discriminate in Indiana, and it just, I'm telling you, George, it is a red herring, and I think it's deeply troubling to millions of Americans, and frankly, people all across the state of Indiana who feel troubled about government overreach. This isn't about disputes between individuals. It's about government overreach, and I'm proud that Indiana stepped forward. And I'm working hard to clarify this. We're reaching out to business leaders. I'm pleased to be on your show speaking across the country on this. We are determined to make it clear that what Indiana has done here is strengthen the foundation and the constitutional First Amendment rights of religious liberty of our people.
I'm trying to get that same clarity. And it sounds to me like what you're saying is that someone could use their religious faith as a defense against any kind of a suit brought there. But let's try to get to that clarification you're talking about. Yep. One fix that people have talked about is simply adding sexual orientation as a protected class under the state civil rights laws. Will you push for that?
I will not push for that. That's not on my agenda, and that's not been...
All right, so I let that clip play in its entirety again, but this is a point that I made on a show earlier, Finding Common Ground, and it's one that I'm going to kind of expound upon today. The only reason that segregation worked in our society when it was allowed was because not only was it legal, it was government mandated. If the government would get out of everyone's business when it comes to how they choose to run their business as far as who they want to serve, who they don't want to serve, then basically what's going to happen is all of the people that want to exclude others will likely wind up going out of business because there will be plenty of other people who won't have an issue with excluding anyone, and therefore they will get that segment of the population's business. But the government has to have us excited and ginned up and freaked out, because then we don't pay any attention to all the other things that are going on because we're too busy talking about Indiana. Which, again, I am talking about today, but only because I'm hoping to try to bring a modicum of common sense to the discussion. Because everybody is flipping a biscuit over this law. This makes no sense. Obama supported the same law when he was in the Illinois Senate. Clinton passed the same law at the federal level before. I feel like anybody remember the Battlestar Galactica remake series from early 2000s? I think it was early 2000s. And it started off with the same line every time. This has all happened before and it will all happen again. I just feel like that's how history is at this point, because the same things keep happening over and over and over again, and depending on the situation and the circumstances, everybody reacts to them differently. It was fine when Bill Clinton passed this law. It was fine when Obama endorsed the same style of law in his home state's Senate. But now that Indiana is stepping up and passing the same kind of law that's already all over the place, all of a sudden, they're being religious bigots. Look, here's the point. You cannot control what's in someone's heart, no matter what. I mean, how many times do we make judgment calls every day when we're running a business? If you're running a bar, you have to decide at some point or another if you're going to cut that person off or if you're going to let them keep drinking. And it's ultimately up to you. And if you do it wrong, you can be sued. Either way. Because what are they going to say now when you stop them from drinking? Oh, well, they're only doing that because I'm Native American, and it's the stereotype that Native Americans can't hold their alcohol, so that's why I only got my two drinks, and then they thought I was drunk, and it's not my fault. I mean, come on. Let's be serious. This is the kind of things that we're opening ourselves up to. It makes absolutely no sense to me. It makes none. Let the market sort itself out. If a cake baker does not want to bake cakes for gay weddings, it's their right to say, look, no, I'm sorry, I'm busy, go to this guy. You know, I'm not saying they should be running around their store with their hair on fire screaming, I will not bake cakes for gay weddings, but if there's a legitimate reason in their mind why they don't feel they should have to do it, they shouldn't be forced to do it. Because all that's doing is expanding and and extenuating the problem. Because the simple fact of the matter is, if we would let the market sort itself out, the market will get rid of a lot of the issues that the government likes to hang on to. But let's look at the real reason why they're hanging on to them, shall we? And this is something that I plan on. I don't know if anybody caught it, but Thursday night, Grouchy and I did an interview with Rod Eccles on Wake Up America. He's going to be back with us this next Saturday. Next up is Friday. So this coming Friday, he will be with me on America Off the Rails. And I plan on asking him this very particular question. And I want you guys to think about it as well. In the now nearly 7 years that we have had Obama as a president, have race relations improved, stayed the same, or have they gotten worse? Because some of it is about perspective and perception. So some of you may see them as being about the same. I personally see them as being about a bazillion times worse. And so I'm going to ask him that question because, you know, that question coming from an old fat Christian white guy is going to sound really, really racist. So I'm going to ask him what his perceptions on that are. So make sure you're tuning in next week. Also, I've got a little bit of an announcement I want to cue up here in just a second. We're going to kind of take a little bit of an impromptu break, only because I'm really excited that this is happening. So bear with me for just a second while I cue something up. Not going to do a bumper, not going to do anything like that. We're just going to roll something real quick, and I'll be right back.
This Monday night, Liberty Unfiltered returns to K98 Talk's awesome lineup. This week, host Steve Long welcomes back to the show Liberty Due to Me CEO Jeffrey Tucker to discuss practical anarchy. Want to learn how to apply anarchy to your daily life? Then tune in at 7 p.m. Central for Liberty Unfiltered, right here on K98 Talk and the Spark Radio Network.
All right, so that was a promo put together by John Wright. That is, for those of you who don't know, he is the voice of K98 Talk. That's why you hear him all over the place. He's actually been in news radio for a good portion of his life, and now we are lucky enough to have him here with us. And just want to give him a big shout-out for throwing that together with us real quick, because I gave it to him last night, hadn't heard from him yet, and the next thing I know, it's in the chat, ready to go. So thank you for all the hard work, sir, and I do have some other stuff I'll be emailing to you this week to get some things changed up. The good news is, for you, some of the newer crew that are coming in actually do their own promos, so we won't have quite as much for you to keep up with, because I know that sometimes you feel like you struggle, but we still want you exclusively here, especially on the Spark Radio side of things, so I still have work for you, so don't get your hopes up about going away anytime soon. All right, big shout out, hats off to both Steve Long for the host of Liberty Unfiltered. He's always been a part of the Spark Radio Network and originally did start on one of our original iterations back when we were on Blog Talk Radio. And then at one point, he got an offer to go elsewhere, so we've continued to help him produce the show along the way and kept him as part of the Spark family. But he has now made the decision, and I do believe a smart decision, to come back to K98Talk.com full-time. And he's now basically on one of what is shaping up to be one of the best nights in radio, because we have me, then him, then Angie and Clay, and then batting cleanup, we have Daniel Stafford of the Stafford Voice. So four really great radio hours back to back to back to back, two from the Spark, two from Politainment, all on K98Talk.com. All right, so had to take that little bit of a break, give a chance to give a shout out to both Steve and John. Just one clarification, because honestly, I didn't have a chance to listen to it before we aired it, and I'll have him fix it for the future versions. It's actually liberty.me, I think, because of the way it was typed up. I think it confused him, but anyway. Okay, so where was I? Oh, yeah. Gay marriage, religious discrimination, blah, 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 blah. Okay, so why, and this is, you know, just my other random thought for it. Why does nobody say anything about all the Muslim bakers in the country that are not currently baking cakes for gay weddings? Anybody got anything for that one? Anybody? Anybody? Bueller? I mean, come on. Look it up. Look it up. It's in there. There are people that are going into Muslim bake shops with hidden cameras and asking them to bake wedding cakes. And they'll say, oh, yeah, sure, we'll bake your cake. And then somebody walks in and it's their wife or their husband. And it's, depending on the situation, either a man already sitting there or a woman already sitting there. And when they realize that they're asking to be made to bake cakes for a gay wedding, not only do they refuse them service, in some instances, they've actually been kicking them out of their store. But, you know, nobody wants to talk about that because, you know, it's just the Christians that are bigots. It's just the Christians that are the evil and terrible ones. I mean, it really is just kind of sad, if you ask me, that we have been basically reduced to a second-class group of citizenry because of our religious beliefs. And that's exactly what's happening. You know, it's like we're trading one form of discrimination for another. And that's why I'm saying at this point, let the market sort it out so discrimination dies out completely. If the government keeps regulating it, the government perpetuates it. And don't even be fooled by all this you and me, free to be you and me, hug a tree hippie crap, because the simple fact of the matter is they want to perpetuate it. Because if they can perpetuate it, then they get to continue to use it. And it becomes a political bargaining chip. I mean, it really is that simple. It becomes a political bargaining chip. This is not that hard of a concept. But the simple fact of the matter is, they want it to be a political bargaining chip. They need it to be a political bargaining chip. Because if you're feeling oppressed, and if you're feeling like your rights are being violated, you're going to vote for the side that always says, hey, we're going to come to your rescue. We're going to do this for you. We're going to do that for you. Not the side that says, hey, can we just put this to bed once and for all and actually let the market figure a few things out? Wow, this is what happened. Never mind. I don't get it. I really don't understand it because this stuff should have been put out of its misery a long time ago. Martin Luther King marched for this. People have bled and died for this on so many different levels. And it just needs to be put to rest once and for all. Color of skin, it's not about any of that. It's not about your sexual orientation. I could give a crap less whether Steve and John want to get married or whether it's Steve and Ann that want to get married. That's none of my business. What is my business is if I, as a business owner, point blank tell you, look, I'm not trying to be rude. I'm not trying to make you feel uncomfortable, but I don't support what it is that you're wanting to do, so I would much rather give you the card of this person here that I know will not have an issue, because that way I know you get the kind of work that you deserve. I mean, honestly, if it were me, money's money. I'm probably going to take the money, but I'm not going to make somebody else do it just because I think it's a good idea to take the money. That doesn't make any sense to me. None of this makes any sense to me, so let's just stop putting the government in the middle of it and let the market sort itself out. The simple fact of the matter is, because this is the argument that everybody makes, well, if we let them continue to discriminate against homosexuals, it's going to go back to the point where we're going to be discriminating against races. No. There may be a few shops that try it. There may be a few folks that try it. But I guarantee you, if the government stayed out of it and just let the market decide, the people are going to go where they're comfortable. The more comfortable they are, the more business those places are going to get, and the less business the ones that make them uncomfortable are going to get. So again, I really do not understand the dilemma here. Let's quit making a big deal about it. Let's let these laws go back to being what they were designed to be, which is not a stopgap for someone to refuse service to a gay person for a wedding cake. It was a stopgap for the overreach of the Obamacare administration and the Affordable Care Act. These laws are designed for government overreach. It doesn't have anything to do with private industry among private individuals. But if we're going to be honest, then let's put the damn situation to bed. It's a really simple concept. If you don't want to bake someone a cake, and you tell them you don't want to bake them a cake, fine, those people should go find someone else who does want to bake their cake, and then eventually 10, 15 friends that they complained to, while Sally Smith down the street wouldn't bake the cake for John and I's wedding because she doesn't think that gay people should get married. But we found Anna Jameson, who basically said, hey, yeah, sure, not only will I bake your cake, but now that you've told me what happened at the baker down the street, I might even give you a little bit of a discount. What do you think is going to happen? Anybody that they know who is going to be doing the gay marriage thing within a certain amount of time will probably be going to Anna Jameson's bake shop to get their cakes, which means there's now an entirely new market that has been opened up to Anna Jameson that has now been closed to John Smith. So why can we not just let the market sort itself out? I mean, it's the same thing. It's the same thing that I was talking to Bryce about earlier, and he didn't want to see it this way. Let me use a different example. What if someone in a Jewish-run bakery had someone come in who was a German and they wanted a swastika on their cake? Should they be forced to put the swastika on the cake? After all, being a Nazi is a lifestyle choice, is it not? That's what we're talking about, right? We shouldn't be able to discriminate against people because of their lifestyle choices. Well, being a Nazi is a lifestyle choice, isn't it? So is the fact that their lifestyle and the history of their lifestyle and their whole particular culture, because let's face it, the Nazi belief system has its own culture. Is it not fair to assume that maybe that shouldn't be allowed to happen in a Jewish bakery? Because by the same arguments the left are using, the Nazi should be able to sue the Jew for not making his cake. It doesn't make any sense to me. I mean, every time, and I keep wanting to get the clip, but I don't want to steal it from Jason because I know he uses it every once in a while. Every time I hear all of this hoopla about one of these new stupid rules, the first thing I think of is that social media car insurance commercial with the little lady standing there screaming, that's not how this works. That's not how any of this works. That's been a recurring loop in my head for a week now, every time this story comes around again about how Indiana is a bunch of racists. I mean, come on. If you missed it, you really should go back and listen to it. You can find it multiple places. His first live show on K90 Talk was this past Wednesday. Jason DeWilkins not only talked about this issue, but he had one of the most dichotomous guests ever that I think I have ever even heard of on his show. And that person, sadly, I don't think I have his information pulled up anymore, so I can't see it. I was going to let you know who it was, but sadly I can't see his name. Anyway, you can find their podcast in multiple places. It's on our Spreaker account now because I didn't allow them to publish it first on their SoundCloud page, but you can always go to their SoundCloud page and check it out as well. If you missed it last night, it actually reran, so where were you last night, you slackers? Come on. PolitiBunny and Jason were on again last night as a replay. I know you heard it. The numbers were pretty good. I know you heard it. Anyway. But yeah, so he had basically I guess it actually came out throughout the course of the show that he was a former homosexual. Was a homosexual who converted to Christianity. And there was something else in the middle that I'm forgetting, but then at some point he actually became heterosexual again. And I don't even think Jason knew that part, because when he said that on the air, he seemed rather surprised. But you really should go back and check out that interview. And at some point, probably this week, I'll see about getting his permission to maybe just put together just the segment with the interview so that we can air it at another time as part of a filler for here and there when we need stuff. But anyway, that being said, this whole thing has been blown out of proportion. And the main reason it's being blown out of proportion is much like everybody made this big deal about the Bibi Netanyahu speech, which honestly, I'm glad it happened. I support Bibi. I stand with Israel. I always will. I'm a Christian. It's in my DNA to stand with Israel no matter what this administration seems to think. And that's never going to change. That being said, I think that Pelosi and Boehner worked behind the scenes, as much as one of them pretended to hate the idea in front of the cameras, to make sure that Netanyahu came when he did, because this was all around the same times that all the secret talks started with Iran. I mean, come on, do you really think all of this came together that quickly? That's what they do. This is all distraction. It's fluff. It's tinfoil. It's chaff. I mean, it's one of those there is no spoon moments, because the simple fact of the matter is you're so busy focusing on this spoon that doesn't even technically exist that you're missing everything else that's going on around you. The simple fact of the matter is our president basically sold our entire country down the river, and Israel along with them. And nobody's talking about it. You know why nobody's talking about it? Because we're too busy arguing with each other over whether or not people should be forced to make other people wedding cakes. And I know, the going back to the wedding cake thing is a simplification of the issue. I get that. I understand it. But it still, it brings it all home when you really let yourself stop and think about it. What if, and then I have another example, which is just as asinine, but just as valid. So we have let's just say for the sake of argument, we have a gay Nazi couple that walks into a Jewish bakery. They want to bake a cake for their wedding, or they want a cake made for their wedding, and they want their figurines to be in the style of Adolf Hitler, and they want swastikas on the sides of the cakes. So when the Jewish baker refused services, is it because they're Nazi or because they're gay, or does it matter? Sorry, but that's about as asinine as this whole argument has gotten over this stupid law in Indiana that's the same one in 20 other states and passed by the damn federal government 20 years before and nobody batted an eye. But why is it such a big deal now? Remember, this is the Obama administration, folks. This is the king of transparency, otherwise known as pay no attention to the man behind the curtain. What's been going on for this entire time that nobody's really talking about until now? Now that the deal has been done, and one of the most laughable things that I've heard, and I'm going to play the clip probably here again in a minute, but one of the most laughable things that I've heard is the Obama administration telling people that if Iran cheats, the world will know. This is the guy who doesn't find out about anything that goes wrong in his administration until he turns on the 11 o'clock news. But if Iran cheats, the world is going to know. Mr. President, you are full of crap. You don't even know when you should or shouldn't go play golf. You don't even know when you should or shouldn't hold a press conference, because a thug, and yes, I call them a thug. You don't like it? Turn off the damn radio. A thug gets killed by police and you hold a press conference. Two police are gunned down in the streets. You send out a twit. Yes, I said twit on purpose. I know that's not the right term, but if the shoe fits, Mr. President, you twit. I mean, I don't understand any of this anymore. I don't understand when we became this whole, everybody's got to get along with everybody else, nobody can have differing opinions. I mean, come on, the next thing you know, they're going to outlaw being able to wear colors, and we're all going to live in the same sized houses that are all shaped like boxes, and we're going to drive the same freaking car. Because we're not going to have a choice. Because if the government continues to tell us what to do, where to go, what to think, what we can do, what we can't do, eventually at some point they're going to tell us everything, because they're already there. They're laying the groundwork today. The Affordable Care Act is the stepping stone to give them complete control of your life from the moment you live until the moment you die, and there's soon going to be absolutely nothing you can do about it. And yet we are fighting over who can make cakes for whom, instead of focusing on the fact that the world is going to hell in a handbasket, and at some point, we are probably all going to either die or glow in the dark, because we're about to let Iran get away with getting a nuclear weapon, and they're going to try to nuke Israel, Israel's going to nuke them in response, Russia's going to get it on just for the fun, freaking Munchkin boy from North Korea is going to try to lob his rocket over this way. It's probably going to land somewhere completely off the mark, because the dude can't hit the broadside of a barn with a rocket launcher, much less an intercontinental ballistic missile. But the simple fact of the matter is the world is going to hell and nobody's paying attention. Not only is nobody paying attention, nobody really seems to care, because we're all too busy fighting about whether or not people can make cakes for other people, when the simple fact of the matter is, if there's a baker that says, "Hey, no, you dumbass, I'm not going to bake your cake because I don't believe that gay people should be able to get married," they don't need to be sued over it. They probably don't deserve to be in business any longer, but they don't need to be sued over it. What they do need is for you to tell all of your friends not to do business with that baker, who then will tell all of their friends probably not to do business with that baker, and eventually that baker won't have a bakery, and all of your business will have gone elsewhere. Again, it's a really simple concept. Let the market figure shit out. This is crap. This government overreach, government overregulation, government getting involved in every aspect of your life from cradle to grave, it's got to stop. I mean, we kid ourselves today. We call ourselves the land of the free and the home of the brave. What is free about this nation right now? You tell me one thing that we still have that's considered freedom, because none of them are real anymore. They're all an illusion. We have gone from being the nation that recognized that we, as human beings, were endowed with certain unalienable rights by our Creator, to we, the American people, have now decided our government knows better for us what we need than we do, and therefore we're going to turn control of our rights and ultimately ourselves over to dear leader so that he can take care of us, so that we don't have to stress so much, because life is hard and it's not fair. Where did this concept of fairness even come from? That's one thing that I never have understood. What puts the idea of fairness in someone else's head? This is not a concept that is conducive to the human condition. We cannot worry about whether or not something is fair. There is nothing in life that is fair. Look at nature. If you run too slow, you get eaten. If your teeth are too dull, you starve. Or you figure out how to eat things that don't try to eat you first. The world is not a nice place. It is not a friendly place. The simple fact of the matter is, we keep trying to form the world into our own image, and somebody else already did that. I know a lot of you, well, not probably not a lot of you, the folks that listen to me already know this, but there are plenty of folks out there that don't believe that is true. And the funny thing is, they will start railing against us for having religious beliefs, when ultimately they're not realizing that they have religious beliefs of their own. We place our faith in someone who is more powerful than us, knows everything, been around since nobody knows when, because he exists outside of time. And they place their faith in their fellow man and in science. I know where I'm going to put my money. And it's not in my fellow man, nor is it in science, because science changes every day. Our science is just as fallible as the creators of said science. I would much rather have faith in the creator that created us all. All right, so at this point, I kind of went commercial-free other than that quick break, so I'm probably about to shut things down here in just a minute, because since I didn't really take any other breaks other than that short one, I've been railing now for about 45 minutes straight. So at this point, we're probably going to shut things down for the day. I will be back with you, I do believe. Yeah, I'm still on the schedule for Mondays. Sorry, I keep changing things around to accommodate new shows, and occasionally I kind of am getting to the point where I'm forgetting what days I'm on. Don't forget, Monday will be the triumphant return of Steve Long right here to live radio programming, specifically on K98Talk.com. So make sure you're tuning in for that as well. He's got a really good guest. He's had him on before, so I know some of you caught it via podcast. So make sure you're tuning in for the live one. Not only that, but Angie and Clay are taking a backseat for this week. They have a new group they're bringing over, so Monday night they will have them in their place. And then, of course, we have Daniel Stafford batting cleanup for everybody, which is the place that the man deserves to be. He's a rock star. The thing about it is, I guess the last couple of stations that he's been at, he's not had very good time slots. So I start talking to people about him, and they're like, "He's part of Bunny's crew? I've never even heard of him." But yeah, so you definitely need to make sure you're tuning in for that, because I've listened to his show for quite some time now. The man is great, and he deserves your attention. Then, of course, we have the new Wednesday nights, which this week I was just notified that Grouchy will be unavailable this Wednesday, so I'm trying to decide if I'm going to do a full 2-hour replay or if I'm going to do a 1-hour replay for him and then go live with myself for an hour and then maybe go into Bunny and Jason, but I haven't decided yet. Either way, his show will be on. It'll either be on for 1 hour or two as a replay, and then, of course, we will have Bunny and Jason. At this point, this will do it for us for this Saturday. The Voices of Global Freedom radio crew, I will have their show up later this evening. Sadly, again, because they are still on Blog Talk, it's difficult for me to live stream them. So if you want to hear them live, feel free to check them out. We don't really have anything playing in that time slot right now anyway. So it comes on 2 p.m. Pacific, 4 p.m. Central, 5 p.m. Eastern, and I will have them up later this evening. All right, so I'm out for the night. You guys are out for the day. You guys take care.
Hey, you guys, I'm getting him. Later.
Game over, man. It's game over.